Good evening. This is the September 25th, 2019 meeting of the Zoning Board of Appeals for the Town of Newcastle. Mr. Secretary.
Before we get started, we have a request from Homeland Powers. Are there anybody here from Homeland?
Yes, yes.
Hello.
Hi.
Chairman, members of the board, my name is Vincent Xavier. I'm the Regional Manager for Homeland Towers. I'm here to you before you tonight because I recently submitted an application for an 18-foot side yard variance for a telecommunications facility project on town property. Brief history, we were actually working in this area to define this site for over 8 years. In July of 2017, I made a formal proposal to the town to lease this property. It went through an over a year process for the town board to approve it. We then submitted our application to the planning board. After a nearly year process there, on July 16th of 2019, the planning board moved to draft an approval resolution to be heard at their next meeting. Concurrently, on that same exact night, the town board modified their code that affected our application. We were not made aware of that until 4 days before the subsequent meeting in September. But that code change removed the power of the planning board to reduce the setbacks as far as they wanted to or could. It made it so that anything less than the underlying setbacks in the district had to go back to the zoning board for a variance. And that's the application before you now, is for an 18-foot side yard setback from one town property to the adjacent town property. I'm here tonight because I really need to ask for a special meeting, because your next meeting on October 30th would hinder the development of the site. It's imperative as a developer that I assume we're going to have a horrible winter. And in order to get the infrastructure in place, I need to have the hole excavated for the foundation and the cement poured before the bad weather comes. So I'm asking if the week of October 14th, you're willing to have a special meeting to hear this request for the variance, hopefully review and approve it, so we can move forward as quickly as possible so that I can have the foundation in before the bad weather starts.
Okay. So the board has reviewed this and has agreed to a special meeting to take place on October 16th. On October 16th at 6:30, we will not have a full board. We will have, though, a quorum that will be necessary to hear the matter.
You'll still need the full three votes to. There are only going to be three members here,
correct,
and you'll need all three votes to get the approval. So
I understand. I think we can justify the need for this variance.
Okay. Is there anything else, Eric, we need to cover?
Just adopt a resolution to set the special meeting, basically. Okay. A motion to set a special meeting.
Excuse me, may I have a word?
On this matter?
Yes. Okay. Okay. My name is Ivan Hauer, and we own the property opposite to the property that is under review from many aspects, and some of the aspects are clearly relevant to the matter as it was planned to be discussed today, and if it's postponed, we will have to come. But that's all right. We are prepared. We are prepared to do that. I just wanted to let you know that, yeah, it's somewhat of an inconvenience, but that should not alter the matter.
Okay.
Also, I want to state that we know the new neighbors very little, but and a little.
Sir, may I interrupt you, please?
Yes.
This is for Homeland Towers. This is not for the driveway and parking area.
Oh.
We didn't get to that.
My apologies. Well, I thought it was to be postponed to October 16th.
No, that's a different case.
My apologies.
That's okay.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Okay.
little concerned there for a second.
I move that the board adopt a resolution that sets...
Close the hearing.
Do we need to close? Is there a...
There is no public hearing, no, it's just setting a special meeting.
That establishes October 16th at 6:30 as the date and time for a special meeting to consider the homeland application.
I'll second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you.
Thank you, have a good night.
See you then, you too.
Next, we have an extension request from the Bagnati American Ellery Johnson Johanna application. They're looking for...
It's a first extension.
First extension, how long? I'll move we grant an extension of 6 months.
Yeah.
6 months on this application, and the usual 1 year to finish after the start of the job.
Extended by a few months.
All right, we'll give them six.
I second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay.
Mount Kisco Country Club.
Good evening. I'm Victor Solarik, VKS Architects, here for the Mount Kisco Country Club. As the board will remember, we were here in July and presented an application for a temporary fabric structure to be installed over two existing tennis courts in the middle of the 27-acre property that contains most of the facilities for the country club. There's total of about 164 acres that the country club owns. About 104 acres are in the town of Newcastle. And we are in talking about a property that's about 27 acres that is adjacent to Bedford Road and kind of surrounded by Annandale Road. If I can put up the drawings, I would put them up so that we can...
It's over here, right?
Yeah.
Even better. So what you see in front of you is the existing site plan, which shows the Bedford Road on the right-hand side, sort of on the north side, and Annandale, Taylor and Annandale Road were turning around in the easterly and in southerly direction, and then circling back up towards the Kittle House restaurant. The shaded area in the middle is the clubhouse, and then you see five tennis courts located on the west side of the clubhouse. The two tennis courts that are sort of in the middle, more towards the south, are the two in question. Page S2, you see the area that's designated for the dome, which is going to be 118 by 118 footprint square, and it's going to be inflatable structure with the apex of the semicircle at 39 feet. So we are also requesting a variance, height variance of 4 feet, where 35 feet is permitted, and we would like to request a 4-foot variance to get 39 in the middle. The section of the dome that would be higher than 35 feet is in the middle of the whole footprint because of the curvature of the shape of the structure. The dome is well within the required setback from the property lines. The closest is about 320 feet from Taylor Road. The other dimensions are more in the 400 and 500 and 600 foot distance. We have received, we have prepared an application in a short and long environmental assessment form, which has been circulated, and the town has received letters from the New York City DEP, New York State DEC, and the Westchester County Planning Board agreeing to have the Zoning Board act as the lead agency, and I'm sure you have that documentation. We also obtained comments from the town engineer, town planner, the building department, and we're working through those comments. The most important currently, as we stand today, are the comments from the town planner, which request certain items to be clarified. And I will quickly just read from them. They're at the end of the memorandum of September 16, and they specifically requested clarifications on the visual impact of the proposed dome on the surrounding properties. We had submitted in August a total of 42 views from the surrounding road and properties towards where the dome would be located. And the board members and everybody has received those renderings. We have actually rendered in the dome, so it's fairly clear the visual impact. We have identified two residential properties that would have some visual contact with the with the dome, with the site. And if I may, I will go to the next page.
So what you see on the right is sort of a key plan of all the views that were taken, and there's a total of 42 locations from which we took pictures and then rendered in the dome. The four that you see on the left-hand side are two conditions, leaf on, leaf off. The one and three are basically from Annandale Road, just below the residential property with the address 56 Annandale. And the bottom two pictures are actually were taken last November, and we have rendered in, you can kind of see it in green, the new proposed dome, which comes over the horizon in between those trees. I can point that out. The dome is shown here and there, and that's the actual size of it with the 35-foot height. In the leaf on condition, there's really no visual contact with that site, but with the leaves off, you would see the top of the dome. The other property is
on Bedford Road, and it's 547 Bedford Road. And in the last meeting, I was rightfully corrected that that property has a visual contact with the site. And so we paid special attention to that viewpoint, wanted to ascertain that, you know, study what the impact might be. So I'll go to the next page.
So has this addressed, the town planner mentioned fall winter views?
Yes, I will.
On 8, 9, and 19?
I will get to it in,
okay,
in a second.
Okay, sure.
So on page A3, this plan was prepared after the received the comments. So, with your permission, I would like to show it tonight, even though it hasn't been submitted 2 weeks prior to the meeting. And I have full copies if I can submit them to the board. But there are a total of 5 pictures that you see on this page, and the 2 on the right, number 6 and 7, are actually taken from the windows of the property at 547 Bedford Road. And they were shown actually at the last meeting by the homeowners.
What is it we're actually looking at?
That's right. So you're looking at directly in the direction of the dome, and I will point it out. The dome is more visible here, and what's important to understand that this and that picture are directly below the house at 547 Bedford from the fairway. So without the leaves, without the trees on their property, it's easier to understand what the visual connection is to the site where the dome is. And so this is the profile of the land up high. This is the profile of the dome that actually it has the 39-foot height at the top. And number 5 is directly in direct line with this view. So you can see the 2 trees, although it's very hard to see because it's kind of dark, but there are 2 evergreen trees which actually show right here in this view. And this is down below, about 30 feet lower from the fairway. That's why the trees appear higher, because the vantage point. But you can see that the dome is, at this point, it is hidden by the trees. As you get higher, the dome starts sort of coming over or close to the top of the trees.
So I'm sorry, could I just try this out?
Yes.
So the house is situated at a lower profile than the fairway and then the
very
dome?
Good point. The house is higher than the fairway, and this section indicates that. So if I'm standing in the fairway all the way along the tree line, basically on the property line, I'm this little person right here, looking up through the trees, just like you see here and there, up the hill towards the dome. If I'm in the house and I'm on the first floor level above the garage, whatnot. So the elevation goes up. These are the elevations, actually. It's a 300, 310. So let's say you're at 320 on the first floor of the house. You're looking this way. You're just looking right over the top, just on the top of the trees, which you see right here. And this is the sight line that you get to see the dome. So a dome kind of comes through, but in a very obstructed way. Here, you really can't see it, but some of it could be the quality of the picture.
So you went into this neighbor's home to take these?
No, no, no. The neighbors were here last, I think they're here tonight.
Yep.
So we took the pictures that they submitted.
I see.
And were able to render in the dome.
Okay.
So we didn't trespass, but we wanted to, really understand what's going on and you know, better present the condition. So I think that this is how we try to address Mrs. Charney's comment regarding the 8 and 9 viewpoint. Number 19, which also was raised, is on another drawing in a similar fashion. In a similar fashion, number 19 is a very wide angle view. Basically, this is the top or the entrance of Taylor Road, and the entrance to the club is somewhere here. So we're looking diagonally across the corner lot, and the dome would be somewhere in this direction. It's very hard to tell, obviously. But again, taking the from the site plan, taking the section from the Taylor Road location, looking in this direction towards the dome. I have not rendered in the trees, just for clarity's sake, but I can show you also a video that I took today walking through the trees. But anyway, so if you take that line, first thing that you encounter is the maintenance barn that is actually on the club's property, and that blocks substantially a big section of that of the viewpoint. And then there's, as you go further, there are other buildings and other obstructions. There's really no direct sight line to the dome.
What color is the maintenance shed?
It's beige.
Beige.
Excuse me, can you clarify that you're showing the views 8, 9, and 19 that the planner suggested?
Can I clarify? Well, so the 9...
This is 19, right? Is that what you said?
Yes.
Yeah. and the last...
But they're supposed to be leaf-off versions.
Yeah, I didn't manage to take all the trees off of the leaves of the trees, but I will...
He's not finished yet, Tom.
I have another aid, if I may. This is actually a leaf-off condition that, again, was taken last November. And that is different... point of view, but I think describes well the condition and the visual connection. And what you see is the proposed location of the dome right here. This is the fence that will remain. So inside that fence would be the dome. This is the steep incline going down to the fairway, all the way across. In the dark area over here, you see a bright spot, and that's the house. I can let you circle it around. To answer Mr. DePauli's question, because the leaves are not off today, we used some of last year's pictures that we took when the leaves were off, and added the section diagrams, which, in my view, indicate the what the visual impact is in those important viewpoints. If I may, I would continue also with some sound information. The dome will be kept up by the help of a fan that actually keeps the structure inflated. And we have gotten information from the manufacturer about the noise levels that the fan would produce. And I also actually went to see an actual dome that Asati put up and measured the noise levels I just wanted to understand what impact it has immediately, standing next to it, and with certain distance. So the noise level about 5 feet away from the unit is 84 decibel, 84.7, I believe, 83.7, 5 feet from the unit, as per the manufacturer's spec. We're proposing to enclose the pad that the fan is going to be on with a picket fence, a solid picket fence, which cuts down on the noise. And then calculating with the distance, how much it cuts down on the noise.
How much does it cut down, that picket fence?
The picket fence?
You said it was 84, yes. 84 without the picket fence.
So we submitted a page C1, which you should have in your packet. And at the closest property line, which is 320 square feet roughly, which is actually along Taylor Road, the decibel level without a barrier would be 47.58. With the stockade fence is 44.48. Those numbers are hard to understand, really, until you try to understand what noise level really is. And there's technology is a wonderful thing. There's actually an app that you can use to measure noise levels. And so as I'm talking, I'm about, 50, 60, and the general consideration is that a quiet library is at about 40 decibel level. So if we stop talking, we are at 48 with the air conditioning humming. So getting down, and so at the property line next to the fairway, kind of closer to 547 Bedford, which is about 700 feet away from the source, the decibel level with the stockade fence would be about 37.1. In other words, it's you really see, you really hear, it's sort of a noise like this kind of noise, you know, background, white noise, bird chirping. I actually, when I was preparing for this, I woke up in the middle of the night and turned this app on and stuck it out the window. And I was still at 38. Couldn't get it down any lower.
If the stockade fence were lined with an absorbent material, would that make an appreciable difference in the noise levels outside of that?
I would assume it would. Mm-hmm. I cannot really tell you how much. Mm-hmm. There are certainly acoustic materials. There are usually panels that are absorbing noise and then prevented from reverberating and bouncing back out, because noise sort of travels same as light with direct line. The more barriers you put up, the less noise will get out into the environment.
Would you consider adding some additional barriers, only because the scenario you're presenting now is with respect to certain machinery and equipment, which when new are going to produce what you say?
Yes.
If they become noisier because of use, or they have to be replaced because they break down.
Right.
We have no way of knowing that the replacement machinery is going to be as at the same
as
level.
Quiet as this, yeah, one.
So it would seem to me you would be better off getting a little bit more noise barrier, even though it puts it down so low that maybe not necessary initially.
I understand with age and maintenance, things could get louder.
Yeah. It seems to me the cost of doing that is minimal, and you would be preparing for
an
eventuality
that's
in the future.
That's part of the reason we thought of, you know, putting a fence around it. It's a solid fence. Certainly a more solid barrier that has actually a sound absorbing characteristics cannot hurt.
Maybe you can get it. What do you think you could get it down to, like 35?
I wouldn't want to guess. I would rely on the expertise of others to come up, to recommend a product that would withstand the natural environment, because it's going to be out in the open, so it has to be durable. It cannot be a homosote panel, which would be usable or appropriate for the inside, but it has to last.
I would like to see something along those lines.
Yeah, sure.
I think I had spoke about this last time we were here, but the units we use, although they're to inflate an air structure, they're actually almost identical to what you put on the roof of this building. So when the club is operating as it normally does during the summer and the fans are on, it's very similar to what you'll expect out of the air structure. When you talk about age, Victor, I took to, just so you know, that building was in Mount Vernon, New York, 22 years old. Almost as old as me. I think Victor was very surprised, and I'd welcome anyone to go down there and visit that site to see just how quiet the units are, even at that age. With replacement of the unit, there are certain codes, volume codes, because of course when anyone puts up a building just as this, the units have to be held to a certain standard. So with age or with a change, most HVAC suppliers are pretty much all held to a certain spec required by code for volume.
No, I realize that you're doing what you think is appropriate at the moment. I'm only suggesting that for a minimal cost, you could add additional buffering, and it wouldn't hurt, and it might end up being something that could help in the future.
I think that's a great idea, and honestly, we should have it fenced anyway, so a little extra padding. Okay.
So the town planner raised some other questions, I think some of which, maybe more than some, you've addressed. I think some others are still outstanding. So is it a case that you're continuing to address these items
to
complete
just
the record?
I think that as far as the town planner's requests or comments, which she mentioned should be resolved before we might get referred to the planning board.
Right.
And so besides the visual, which I have tried to address, there was also a technical aspect of the zoning table, which is on page S2.
Right.
Which addresses actually nothing that has to do with the proposed dome, but it's a basketball court that has been installed and it has a variance. So we had in the upper right-hand corner, hopefully you can see it. In the upper right-hand corner, there's a revised zoning table which shows the requested 39-foot, or I should say 4-foot variance for the height of the dome, and also mentions the basketball court setbacks, which the variance was granted in 2008.
So, because I can't read that, so that addresses the site coverage and.
Well, the site coverage that you're reading was addressed already, on with the submission.
It was.
Yes.
Okay. And then, Have you addressed the issue of the hours of operation as it relates to...
Yes, the hours of...
I think you've said that during the winter months, the dome will match the hours of the clubhouse, yet I'm not sure...
The question is what the clubhouse hours are.
Right.
So it's 6 to 10.
Okay.
10 p.m.?
10 p.m.
And the issue about members versus guests and who can play...
So it's strictly for members.
Okay.
There is a population or membership, part of membership, who are members almost exclusively for tennis. They want to use the facility year-round. That's the whole purpose of putting this up. And there are no leagues or other organizations that would be renting it or using it for other purposes.
Okay.
It's strictly for the club members. If they invite friends or guests, they have to be present. They have to come with them. So it cannot be...
And you're going to make that notation on the site plan?
Yes, correct.
Or have already, right?
I will note it on the site.
The dome is only up for 6 months a year, correct?
Correct. Yeah, maximum 180 days.
Have you given further consideration to the color being other than green, being white?
We have, and I believe you have gotten a submittal of two samples. One is green and one is light gray. I think that given the location and the site conditions, I feel that the green would blend in better, even though in winter months you don't see much green. It's just a darker, less contrasting color. But should the board feel that light gray is the right color, I don't think that the club is going to object, nor will Donato.
You made the comments about the white, that
white.
It would be a, yeah.
White is the most, you know, economically chosen color for most domes that are in the area.
Yeah.
It doesn't absorb the heat, it reflects the heat.
Doesn't absorb the heat, you would be able to...
You still have sun still.
Use less energy, I guess, in cooling, whatever. What else did you say?
Mostly heating in winter.
No, but you still have to make heat inside the building. This is a heated structure and the fans are running, so the more you have to adjust the climate, the more the equipment is running, so the byproduct of that would be less noise at the same time. The equipment is not running.
And how about visual?
Visual, white blends into more wintertime atmospheres than the green does.
That's what
it's not a naturally occurring. We do have evergreens, but white is more prominent in the clouds, in the darkness, in the sky during winter months.
What about the gray?
Gray is equally as good. An Ansel gray is a clean palette. That would be acceptable.
The way I feel, white would be, if there were no snow around, would just be glaring out there. Gray to me would be a better choice.
That would be acceptable. Their clubhouse is white, so it would blend in with white structures.
Well, okay. I still lean to gray.
That's fine.
What does the manufacturer, what's his experience as it relates to?
So the white is the most common, you're 100% correct. But when we're working with Westchester Country Club, surrounded by multi-million dollar homes, they did not take my advice on the white or the gray, and they went with the green. And to be honest with you, I love how it blends in the winter. I was stunned and surprised. With that said, it's what gives you a comfort level. All three are readily available. I also recently did another building in, I think it's in that package, the light gray, very, very neutral. So it's not stark white, it's not stark green. It kind of just looks like a gray, cloudy day, and it blends into the skyline.
Yeah, I think the gray makes more sense. I know green is a color that is most visible. That's why they use it for traffic signals and those sort of things. So I think you want the least visible, which would be a gray.
Was there anything more that you wanted to present this evening?
I believe that pretty much does it. The hours of operation we talked about, the CEQA process, the exposure. Well, there's one other thing just on the visual. There's another property which I kind of skimmed over. It's 56 Annandale Road. They do have visual connection. We also showed the pictures. The owner actually submitted a letter in support of this application. So okay. I don't know that we have to go into detail.
Right. Okay.
There's one other thing I want to get perfectly clear.
Yes.
On the use of the facility, there will be no tournaments allowed? I mean, not people coming from another club to...
No, the intention is to play in the club league.
Club league.
No USTA, no outside groups having a tournament against Monkeys Cove Country Club.
Yeah, that,
was pointed out, there's plenty of other facilities that do that kind of business, and then they you know, thrive.
I would be very concerned about traffic.
Right, exactly. One other thing actually that you reminded me of, a question was raised about the occupancy of the building. We have listed it at, I forget the number, I think it was 90.
90.
Right. But that's strictly by square footage. I have to provide sufficient number of exits from the facility, and that is based on the square foot occupancy of the facility. However, it's not intended to have 9 people there, because really only 8 people can play doubles on the 2 courts. And if they have 2 friends or spectators or somebody to cheer them on, that I think would be the extent of it, or coach.
Okay, thank you. Is there anyone in the audience who wishes to speak to this application this evening?
I just have one question.
Okay.
For the architect on the coverage issue, I know you provided information relating to the variance required for the coverage. What's the exact variance you required for the coverage?
Well, the as Sabrina pointed
could,
out,
sir, if you could come to the microphone,
I'm sorry.
Please. Thank you.
The cover, because this is a special use, it really doesn't fall into the R1 acre zoning. And the coverages are calculated on all properties and all sites in the town of Newcastle. And I think the overall coverage is, forgive me that I don't remember that,
There's a note.
Yes, so the applicant has revised the coverage accordingly for each lot. The building coverage for all structures on the 3 lots is currently 5.8%. The existing development coverage is 9%. The proposed action will increase the site development coverage for the entire site, all 3 lots, to 9.1%. So by 0.1 percentage point. No additional building coverage is requested. The interesting thing is that it's really just the perimeter of the dome, because the courts exist and they count into the coverage calculation. So those are basically just the pads for the equipment and the little walkway that comes from the existing walkway to the dome.
Okay. Yes, sir. You want to be heard?
Hi, good evening. My name is Joe Lecce, 547 Bedford Road. We are one of the 2 houses that was mentioned on the application here. We were back here in August presenting, and we do object to this installation going in. I think what we've seen tonight is a little bit of progress from the sound and the visual standpoint, but however, looking at that A3 drawing that was presented before with the sight lines, it's pretty obvious that they're showing a direct line of sight from our living room right into that bubble. Across the fairway. Most people here don't see it, but during the winter time, the trees are completely vacated with leaves, so that's your most visual time of the year. We look down into the fairway, we look down and pretty much right across into that bubble. From the standpoint of putting a colored bubble up there, I do disagree with I think the green is going to be a strong object that's going to really stand out in the background. And that's going to be a little bit objectionable. From my position, I think white would be a much better option. Something that does blend into the background, something that, you know,
I mean, have you been able to consider the gray?
Honestly, I've never really seen a gray bubble before.
Right.
I am a very active tennis player. So
I heard what you said. I just didn't want you to
limit yourself to...
Yeah, I think a gray, would be a better option than a green at that time.
Okay.
So from there, from that standpoint. Well, from the 8-3 drawing, it's very obvious. Our front line window view right out into the country club is going to be right into this bubble. And there's no exceptions. They could say what they want. I have the view. I live here every day. I live it.
Can you see other structures?
We can see their entire property, essentially.
Right.
What we don't really see is the, what we really don't see is a lot of it, because most of the structures are very low flying.
Right.
They're typically, what, 20, 25 feet high. They just built a small paddle tennis facility there a couple of years ago. It was only about maybe 15 feet high.
But the clubhouse or this maintenance shed or other structures?
Nothing there is really that objectionable. I mean, they do have a big maintenance shed in the back there, which was always there and present from when the time I moved there, so I really have nothing to say about that. It's pretty high. I mean, we can see that in the winter.
And you know the height limitation in for buildings is generally 35. They're asking for a variance from that of like four feet.
Well, that's a whole nother objection.
So the bubble, the height of the bubble, which is only the top part of the bubble, is only going to be 4 feet above what the town permits as a matter of right.
Correct. But why should the town permit something that's not permissible in the town?
Oh, that's why we're here.
Especially within a very residential neighborhood, a very nice, you know, fairly high-end residential neighborhood. This development is not for the betterment of the town. It's not for the public. Is for private use, so I don't understand why a few select houses are going to be impacted by this installation at this time. If it's something they could do that's not going to be visually impacting us and or sound impacting us, that could be a different discussion. But right now, I don't see either. So those are really the issues with the visual. From the standpoint of the sound, we are going to hear that unit. We are in open range to the whole fairway. The way the units are being proposed are on the backside of the bubble, which is probably the worst spot from our position, because all that noise is now going to be radiated out into the fairways and out to the property lines. We are going to be probably one of the most recipients of that noise. We do get quite a bit of noise from their facility now on weekends from parties and et cetera, et cetera. But it's incremental, so it's really not that bad, and we don't have too much objection to that. I'm a professional engineer, HVAC, so I do this every day for a living. You could talk about adding one unit, not going to add sound to the area. But if you take one unit, add it to another unit, add it to another unit, it becomes an A-weighted decibel factor. It compounds the sound, and it increases the sound. So if you have three units on the property and you add a fourth unit, it's going to increase the sound. So I'm not so sure where some of the statements came about the sound not being increased in there. From a standpoint of the report that was given, I'm hopefully it's done by an acoustician, not just done by the architect's cell phone and his app that he has on there. But I think, Mr. Bonaparte, you were directly right about putting some type of attenuation on there. If they are going to allow this installation to go forward, they should definitely be looking at further attenuation on the unit. What's going to happen in the wintertime, this unit's just going to reverberate out on the 10, 15 degree nights, and it's going to be noisy. I could hear a pin drop in my neighborhood at 10 o'clock at night if you walk outside. So you really can't say you're not going to hear it. This is a unit, too, that's going to need to run 24/7. Not going to run a couple hours during the day when we're at work. You know, it's not going to shut off at 7 o'clock at night. And it's going to run 24/7 because the bubble is a pressurized system. It needs to be maintained pressurized. So that noise is going to be running and operating around the clock. So those are some of the big issues with the noise in there. From standpoint of the colors, again, I think white would be the best choice at that time from there. But I'd like to say we are definitely impacted by this. We may be one of two people, but I just don't feel it's just that one or two people in the neighborhood and zoning law should be changed or allowed permissible to accommodate private use for and impacts only a couple of people.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Could I just ask the architect?
Sure.
The location of the air compressor or the
yeah.
unit, how did you come to that location versus... Is it possible there's another location that would not impact directly this particular neighbor?
I actually wanted to talk about that again, an alternative location.
Well, but let's let him speak first.
So given the existing locations and the lay of the land,
yeah.
The two courts are
located between the clubhouse and the rather steep hill down to the fairways. So there's a lawn between the clubhouse and the two tennis courts. I think that that area would be less appropriate for the fans to be located on. On the north side of the two proposed tennis courts, there's another two tennis courts, and there's about 12-foot space between the two fences. So I don't think that really would physically work. The possible location could be considered on the south side.
Sorry, those are courts that wouldn't be used during this period.
That's correct.
Of time, right?
That is correct. Right. But you need clearance to just be able to actually get in between and to one of the exits. But on the south side of the dome, where the grade goes up a little bit, one could potentially see maybe change the grading and then put the units there. They would probably have to be. There would have to be some adjustment in the grade to create a large enough area that would actually be able to house that equipment and probably retaining walls, which at the end of the day might improve the sound situation.
Okay. I think it's worth noting that I think it's something that you should consider. Okay?
Okay.
Anyone else who wishes to speak to this? You get another comment on this?
In regard to the approach. In regards to their locations, they're proposing.
And this, oh, I'm sorry. If you're going to speak, you could take the microphone out of its, and if you want to come forward.
In regards to the proposed location, we have the unit shown right here, which is on the opposite side of the fairway. They could take this whole structure and slide it a little bit and locate these units within the inside, which then be on the inside of their bubble between their existing facility and their bubble, which is definitely going to help mitigate the noise coming out into the fairway. And the noise that would definitely radiate out into all different areas.
Can I have a look?
Right.
Yes.
Sure.
Thanks.
Show them what you have.
We have the units which are located here and here right now. Right here is where the fairways are walking out into here. This is all the open space where the noise is radiating. From my standpoint, what I see is a better location from noise transmission and sound to the neighborhood is to be locating it within these locations here, because it's going to be buffered. From that back side, it's going to be buffered from this side with these existing facilities here and your new facility here. But then you have that noise transmission radiating out to the other tenant.
It helps me. There's a hill that goes up. There's a gazebo and other structure up the hill, so there's actually quite a bit of a knoll before you get down to Annandale. From this point of view.
Well,
anyway, so
I don't mean that we're going to resolve this evening, but
we'll take it under advisement.
Heard the comments.
Absolutely.
Yes, please. Okay.
Doug? Want that copy to
yes. If you could give it to our secretary right here, that'd be great. Thank you. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak to this application?
Hello. Hi. Christine Lecce, actually, 547 Bedford Road. I just have a couple of questions on. Well, first of all, thank you for supplying the view from our home. And I just wanted to note that it was a very dark view. So I think even though, you know, I was kind of surprised that it was, you know, not as visible as I thought it was going to be, but it was also a really dark picture. So I think it might be just a little more visible than that, than what was shown. And I was a little surprised that we didn't get pictures from view number 19 without the trees. So I don't know who's going to be impacted from view number 19, but it's not, I guess it's not going to be me. It's somebody who lives over there. I'm a little, you know, with all due respect to the tennis players, you know, I mean, essentially what we're doing is we're.
You're a golfer.
Oh, God, no.
No, okay.
It's fear. What we're going to do is, you know, we're talking about gray, green, white. I mean, obviously, it's going to have an impact. We can't, you know, deny that. And you said yourself that it's going to be eight people at a time on the court. So, you know, we're kind of like making a huge impact on that area. The golfers at the club, I don't know if they're on board. For a handful of eight people at a time playing tennis,
I don't know, 6 a.m. to 10 p.m.? Is everyone going to be on that court at that time all day? Are we going to have people there all day? Are we going to have a handful of moms there playing during the day? And then maybe at night after work, some moms coming home from work playing?
I think it's partly a case of you build it and will they come? So their hope is that it will, you know, have a positive impact on the membership who today don't have this option. And we're here to listen to you, to listen to the applicant, mm-hmm. and to try to see if there isn't a way to mitigate the impacts as they relate to you.
Build a building.
I'm sorry?
Build a building with some interior courts. I mean, Sawmill Club has a building with interior courts. They don't have all bubbles, you know, and then
I personally,
I'm just saying.
I don't know if that's a better circumstance for you or not.
Well, you know what? It's better than looking at a big green blob or gray or white, but if that's what it's going to be, that's what it's going to be. Again, I'm not convinced about the noise, and I'm not convinced that there's not going to be a humming noise. I don't think that I would like the humming noise all night and all evening, particularly if I'm outside with my dog or whatever. I do like to hear birds. The other question I have is that I'm a little concerned that we don't know for sure, is everyone in the club on board with this? And is there a mechanism for the board of the club to garner the votes? Does the board have to garner the votes to approve this? Do the members have to approve the expenditure? Have they approved the expenditure? Go ahead.
The concerns you're voicing now, I'm not understanding why you're concerned with
I'll tell you why. Because if you go down, what is it, Hunts Lane off the Sawmill Parkway, and there's a half-constructed pilings over there because the people have been fighting amongst themselves about who's going to do what, and nothing's getting done. If they build what happens if this gets started and some people in the club say, you know what, we never approved this? I'm just saying, I think it should be looked into to make sure that this signature on the application, which was submitted on May 30th, 2019, was in fact signed by a property owner, because it does say it was signed by a property owner. I don't know who that is. Do they have?
We will take care of seeing.
Because if it's not, it could be stopped midway.
We understand.
And then we get stuck with that.
Right.
Again, you're going to do what you're going to do. If you could mitigate this in any way, I would really appreciate it with the lighting, the noise, the sound, the impact visually. And consider that, you know, we're doing, you know, if you build it, they will come or they won't. And it's a big bubble to go up in the hopes of that. So, and again, you know, it's not just us. I think it's going to impact the people walking their dog on Taylor Road, which I've known I do, and the people taking runs on Annandale. Excuse me. They're all going to see it. So that's all. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Is there anyone else? Okay, so we're going to adjourn this matter, carry it over to the next meeting.
With respect to CEQA, the notice of lead agency was circulated. 30 days have passed, so that time has, for comments from other involved and interested agencies, has passed. The board now, based on the comments from the Planning Commission, what you hear tonight, you have to decide whether there's sufficient information in the application to refer it to the planning board, or whether you want the applicant to submit additional information with respect to sound engineering or leaf off views that could be provided at this time of year before submitting it for a referral to the planning board. So that's what the board has to consider.
So I would like to suggest that the applicant meet with the town planner, complete all open issues, address all open issues, and we will hear from both the applicant and the town planner come next meeting. And I think then we will have the information we need to come to a conclusion.
Yeah, I agree.
I'm very interested in the possible relocation of the air handling equipment. I think that had bothered me from the beginning, that the air handling equipment seemed to have been put on the back of the dome to protect the people in the club and the clubhouse, and without regard to where that sound was going to emanate and terminate. I would feel better if the equipment were put in a location that would protect the neighbors, even if it allowed more sound into the club area. I think if it's their dome, they should hear it, not everybody else. So that should be seriously looked into before we go any farther.
I'm sorry, I have a question. On the noise decibel level, there was a form, I didn't see it, but was there a professional company that ascertained the decibel level of that? Or was that?
It's supplied by the manufacturer.
Okay. But in that environmental, in that particular environment, would there be some way for us to know if it were a different decibel level, if there were a null there, as you mentioned, that it bounced off certain structures or?
Well, so the decibel level calculation is a formula that is a logarithm of the distance. So that's how the noise level decreases with the distance. In terms of calculating the reverberation of the dome or other structures, the only way to ascertain that, and it's done more on the interior, where you can actually build a model of interior space and calculate the sound levels at different areas of the points of in space. On the outdoors, once the noise is out, it emanates in all directions. It doesn't bounce off of anything other than the adjoining structure, like we talked about the fence or the dome.
The only other note, there was a submission from New York State Department of Environmental Conservation with a number of comments in response to the lead agency notice, and there was one comment regarding cultural resources. There should be a submission to the New York State Historic Preservation Office. I don't know if that was done, but that should be, if it hasn't been done, that should be taken care of as well.
It's in the process of being done.
So then the board could, if the board wants to adjourn till the next meeting, just a motion to adjourn the meeting, keep the public hearing open.
I move that in the matter of Mount Kisco Country Club Realty Corp, we adjourn this meeting until next month, and we have a completeness to the application so that the board can consider it.
One second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Thank you. See you
Thank
next
you
month.
Much. I'll take my
You ready for the next one?
Okay.
The state of Marion Kitts.
Good evening. Chairman, members of the board, my name is Lee Pollack. I am with the firm of Pollack & McGuire. We're attorneys for Mark and Deborah Kitts, who are the applicants. Also here with me this evening are Mark and Deborah Kitts and James Ryan of the JMC Consulting Engineers firm. With your permission, I'd like to ask Mr. Cordone can sit at the table and run the PowerPoint to help move us through this. Members of the board, this appeal concerns the application, or I would say the misapplication, of a very obscure provision of the zoning code, section 60-420A4C. which for ease of reference I would refer to as the merger provision. As an overview, essentially that merger provision precludes owners of a lot that is a legal, non-conforming lot from their right to otherwise develop that lot merely because of their ownership of another adjacent lot. That in itself is unfair given the fact that that particular provision is so obscure and given the fact that it would be so easy for them and their predecessors to have taken ownership in different names. They could have taken ownership as husband and wife, husband owning one parcel, wife owning the other parcel. They could have taken ownership in corporate name and LLC, but because of their ignorance of this particular provision, they didn't do that. That in itself is unfair. As we'll demonstrate, not only is the very fundamental sense of the merger provision unfair because it's so obscure, but in this particular case, it's so ambiguous and so difficult to understand how to enforce it that it should not be enforced. We'll get into that. Let me start with the applicants. Mark and Deborah Kitts are the heirs of Lawrence and Marion Kitts, who owned property on Alden Road in Chappaqua since 1978. They also owned Lot 15 in the subdivision since 1978. The property itself, Lot 15, which is the subject of this application, as you can see, there, that's a copy of the subdivision map. Now, that subdivision map was approved by the Planning Commission. It was then known as the Planning Commission of the Town of Newcastle in 1938. Contained 22 lots, and two of those 22 lots were lots 14 and 15. Lot 15 is the lot that's the subject of this application. Lot 14 is known as 5 Alden Road. The issue is, did those two lots merge as a result of this merger statute? As you can see, Lot 15, which is the lot for which an application for a building permit was submitted, is 0.82 acres. And if you look at the other lots in the subdivision, they are virtually all 0.82 acres or less. The only lots that are larger are the lots that are on the north end of the subdivision around the cul-de-sac. So we're essentially asking for a building permit for a lot that is the same size as every other lot in this subdivision. What I'd like to ask is that Deborah Kitts, who is familiar with the parents' use of the property, address the question of how the property has been used historically. I'd like to ask her to come up now. Deborah?
Good evening. First, my brother and I, Mark, would like to thank you for considering our application and for your time this evening. I'm just going to spend a very few moments providing some background about our parents' purchase and use of the property in Chappaqua, and then Mark will provide you with an overview of recent activities regarding the property. Our parents purchased the property in August of 1978 to be closer to our father's place of business. He worked for IBM, and moved from Long Island into the house on 5 Alton Road during the latter part of that month. In fact, it was a heck of a weekend because the day after my parents moved from Long Island up to Chappaqua, my father had to take me to Philadelphia to start my senior year in college, and several days later, my parents drove Mark to Rhode Island to start his freshman year in college. It was quite a busy time for our parents, but they were very excited to start becoming part of the Chappaqua community. Our parents lived at the house in 5 Alden Road, which, as Lee said, is known as Lot 14, until their deaths, our father passing away in 2002 and our mother in January of this year. At no time during that 40-plus year period did our parents improve Lot 15 in any way, erect any structures on Lot 15, or landscape that lot. They did, however, take responsibility for removing trees that occasionally fell during storms from the lot onto Winthrop Road, the road on which the lot faces. It is important to note that our parents understood that they purchased, and I'm using air quotes here, a double lot. They called what we know Lot 15 to be the woods. Our father's other term for the woods was their, or my air quotes again, their ace in the hole, meaning that they understood that should the financial need arise, the woods could be sold to a developer, allowing our parents to use the proceeds to support their living expenses. In more recent years, subsequent to my father's death, I took on an increasing role in our mother's financial matters. On numerous occasions during this recent time period, when I asked our mother about how she wanted me to handle things if her liquid assets were near depletion, her consistent response was, "We'll sell the woods." Unless there are any other questions, I'm going to stop at this point and turn things over to Mark so he can provide more information about recent activities with regard to this lot.
So I'm sorry. So when your parents purchased the two lots, their intention was always to hold this second lot forever without it making any improvements to it?
There never was any discussion about improving the second lot for themselves in any way. It was this ace in the hole, as my father called it.
Okay.
So in January of this year, once our mother passed away, I made initial contact with the tax assessor because we got some good advice that we needed in order to sell two separate lots, that we needed to have separate tax bills. So I spoke with the tax assessor, sent the requested note to restore the two lots from a tax perspective. Restore the two lots to their original state, and on February 13th.
I'm sorry. What does that mean? Restore them to their original state.
They originally were two tax lots.
Right.
Paid, and then at some point, I don't know the exact date, but they were merged from a tax administrative perspective.
Okay.
And I'm using the best terminology I can. So in order to sell them as two separate lots, we were advised to get them restored to their original state. So as you can see here, highlighted in yellow in the upper left, then on February 13th, the tax assessor gave us permission, told us that we were all set from a tax perspective. It would show up in June, and that we could proceed in listing the two lots separately. There's a note here from the tax assessor to Christina Papeson and Sabrina about the fact this was the two lots were an administrative merge only. And along the way, just a note that I never got any guidance in terms of if there was anything else I needed to do in order to have permission to list the lots separately. One of the things we knew we needed to do was to get Westchester County Board of Health approval for septic on Lot 15. So we worked closely with Rain Concepts, Jeremy Renato, heads that organization led us through the process of getting Board of Health approval on that lot. And you can see that we got the approval on April 1st of this year. From there, we proceeded to agree with contracts on lot 15, you'll see the dollar amounts in a minute, and that was for $589,000, and then 5 Alden Road was $683,000. So the total is $1,272,000 between the two. Both have contingencies on getting the building permit. As you may know, the building permit was denied. One of the next steps we took, go ahead, was...
And I'm sorry, why was it denied?
It was denied on the basis that there had supposedly been a merger of the two lots, lot 15 and the 5 Alden Road lot. And if the two lots had merged and there's a structure on the lot, the basis for the denial was you can't build two structures on one lot.
Go ahead. We certainly recognize that a difference of $552,000 is significant, you know, financially, and potential significant hardship for Debbie and I. So one of the steps we took was to have sort of a market evaluation of if we were forced to sell it as one lot, and so on. That was $700,000 to $720,000. And if you go to the next slide, this is just a quick summary of the difference in value, right? one versus two. So,
okay.
So we've got a situation where, as a result of the denial, the estate of Kitts is being deprived of $500,000 in value.
Right.
And the issue is, was the denial proper? We're asking for essentially four prongs of relief from this board. The first prong of our relief request is to find that because the merger statute is so vague and ambiguous, and under the law it must be strictly construed in the applicant's favor, it can't be applied. Okay. And I'll explain that later. The second prong is that based upon case law, where there are back-to-back lots or L-shaped lots, the merger clauses are held not to be applicable under the case law. This is essentially like back-to-back or L-shaped lots. I'll explain that later. The third prong is that if this board finds that, in fact, the merger statute was properly applied, we are asking for a variance in view of the extreme hardship and the fact that granting a variance to permit this construction will have absolutely no deleterious effect on the neighborhood. What it would do effectively is it would take a lot that was always intended to be built and allow it to be built. And alternatively, and this is, we don't think this is a particularly good alternative for several reasons, but alternatively, we would ask if none of the first three alternatives were to be granted, we would ask that area variances be granted for both lots, subject to re-subdivision by the Planning Board. Let's talk a little bit about why this particular merger provision can't be applied. Under the case law, in that case, Allen against Adami is a New York Court of Appeals case, and it basically articulates the principle that zoning regulations being in derogation of the common law
must be strictly construed against the municipality and in favor of the property owner. And as the court said in this case, any ambiguity in the language used in such regulations must be resolved in favor of the property owner. Now we'll take a look at this particular section, 6420A4, reads as follows. I'm not going to read all of it, but it basically starts out with referring to new buildings on substandard lots having less than the minimum area, and says a permit may be issued provided, A, the lot met the zoning requirements at the time the deed to the lot was recorded, and there's no question about that being met. B, all yard setbacks and other building-related requirements which are in effect at the time of the obtaining of the building permit are complied with. There's no question of that. The proposed plans would comply with all yard setbacks and building-related requirements in effect at the time of the application. And C, and this is the merger clause, the ownership of such lot was not the same as other lots contiguous thereto at any time on or after the adoption of the zoning ordinance or amendment making such lot nonconforming in area. And then here is the problem. The statute reads, if the lot was not in separate ownership, such other lot, and then it says, or so much thereof as may be necessary, shall be combined with a first name lot to make one or more conforming lots. Well, if you look at the two lots, we've got one lot that's 0.82 acres and the adjoining lot that's 0.68 acres. Look at the statute, and what it says is you take so much as necessary and combine it with the lot for which the application was made. So if you follow the town statute, what you should do is take 0.18 acres from 5 Alden, combine it with 5 Alden is the neighboring lot. Take 0.18 acres from 5 Alden, combine it with the 0.82 acres on lot 15, and you have a conforming lot. And that's what the statute says. And if applied literally, what that means is that you've got to take a slice of property from the adjoining lot, which was in co-ownership, combine it.
Adjoining lot, the improved lot.
Which is the improved lot.
The improved lot.
You take 0.18 acres from the improved. It doesn't say anything about how you handle it, if it's improved, if it's not improved, if it's conforming, if it's not conforming. None of that is addressed in this statute. And that's the problem.
So how do you read the words, if necessary?
If necessary.
Necessary.
Right. As may be necessary means as much as is necessary to make a conforming lot.
Conforming lot to the lot that is unimproved.
The lot that is the subject of the, that's right, to turn the unimproved.
Why is that lot nonconforming?
It's nonconforming because it's 0.82 acres and not 1 acre, and at the time of the subdivision, the zoning was half acre.
Right.
The zoning became 1 acre. If it wasn't...
What year was that?
I believe it was in the 1940s. One of the things we tried to do, and Jim, I'm not sure whether you got it, we tried to get from the town the exact date that the zoning was changed from half acre to 1 acre. I believe it was around 1949, but we actually could not get the precise date.
So when they changed the zoning code to make that area 1 acre zoning, all the lots in that subdivision, what happened to them?
They became nonconforming lots.
Aha. Uh-huh. Legal nonconforming.
Yes. Yes.
Legal.
Yes.
Okay. So if lot, the 5 Alden, lot 15, is a legal nonconforming,
yes,
why is it necessary to add anything to it?
Well, it's only necessary in terms of this statute. I don't think it makes any sense.
No,
But it doesn't make any sense, and that's why I
What doesn't make sense is your interpretation, saying that it's necessary.
Well, in the context of this statute, where it says, if it was not in separate such other lot, or so much thereof as may be necessary, it seems to me it's clear it's as may be necessary in order to make a conforming lot.
So if you don't need to make it a conforming lot because it's a pre-existing legal non-conforming use, what happens? There's no merger.
That's right. Mm-hmm. That's right. Which is exactly what we're saying, is you can't, because of the way this statute reads, there should not have ever been a merger, and the denial of the building permit should be overturned by this board. That's exactly right. The only reason why the building permit was denied was on the basis that there was a merger. Right? So if either you do something that doesn't make any sense, which is to take 0.18 acres from an already non-conforming developed lot and combine it with the lot that is the subject of the application, or you conclude that there was no merger, and I totally agree. There should not have been any merger, and the permit should have been issued.
I'm just suggesting that as a possible interpretation. It wasn't raised by you initially, but it appears to me from reading the statute, it's fairly clear. As may be necessary. If it's not necessary, then you don't combine.
Right.
If you don't combine, then you end up with two
legal non-conforming lots.
Right.
Yes. That's what we think we have, and we think that a building permit should have been issued because...
Does that make any sense at all? I mean...
Maybe at the time frame when the change from half acre to 1 acre, we're looking at this as today's code, and it says you have to make one or more conforming lots, conforming being 1 acre in size.
And my point is, I don't know how you do that consistent with the goals of the zoning code, which is, and the only way you could do that is by taking so much as is necessary, and if 0.18 acres is necessary, then you take it from the non-conforming, from the existing 0.62 acre lot, and you've got, or 6.8 acre lot, and then you've got a half acre lot that's even more non-conforming. And the quandary is you just can't do it. And based upon the clear case law, that if there's an ambiguity in the code, you can't interpret it against the property owner. You have to say that in this situation, this particular merger clause should not have been applied. Now,
if I might add, if you take the 0.18 away from 5 Alden, mm-hmm. it becomes a half acre parcel, mm-hmm. which becomes extremely non-conforming.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Makes it even more non-conforming.
Absolutely.
Correct.
So, I mean, I think... statutes are written, they don't always fit all circumstances. We know that.
And my point, and we're not saying that this statute is not enforceable under some circumstances. I would say that clearly what this statute did not contemplate was that the adjoining parcel would, A, be already a non-conforming parcel, and B, would already have been developed. And given the fact that that was not contemplated by the statute, the answer is you can't enforce the statute against the property owner.
I also think the merger statute appears to have been added to the code in 1978.
It was amended in 92 to take out the section that allowed for the owner to subdivide it.
So the bad merger aspect is only been added in 92, then, you said.
That is correct.
Now, we have other arguments as well. The other argument is based on the case law. It's in our memorandum, but very briefly, the case law says that two back-to-back lots don't merge under a merger provision, and two lots that make up an L-shaped lot don't merge under a merger provision. What those two lines of cases have in common is that that in each instance, they prohibit the merger of lots that front on different streets. And that's exactly what we've got here. We've got 5 Olden fronting on Winthrop, and we've got lot 50. I'm sorry, thank you, Olden. We've got 5 Olden fronting on Olden and lot 15 fronting on Winthrop. Yes. And the point of that is it would not have been intended to affect a merger under those circumstances. I think combining that case law with the ambiguity of the statute, and there are other reasons why the statute's ambiguous that I'm not going to get into here. It doesn't work with other provisions of the zoning code. For all those reasons, we would urge that this board overturn the decision that denied the building permit and direct that a building permit be granted. Now, if the board chooses not to do so, what we would urge is that a variance be granted that would nevertheless permit Lot 15 to be built. And the variance that we would ask be granted is a variance from the application of the merger statute. With regard to the grounds for the variance, I would ask Mr. Ryan to address the board.
Thank you. Good evening to the Zoning Board of Appeals. For the record, my name is James Ryan, principal of the firm of JMC. We've been retained by the Kitts family, the Kitts estate, to address issues of engineering and general planning related to any possible subdivision. What I'm going to talk about specifically is talking about the environmental features of the property, how this property is more than suitable for development. The Kitts family, Deborah Kitts has already indicated, and Mark Kitts has already indicated that they did some work on this property, and this was prior to our firm getting involved, which showed the buildability of this lot, the lack of environmental features on this property that might prohibit or constrain development, such as wetlands, steep slopes, and watercourses. Also, I want to address quickly the consistency with the neighborhood. We've referred to it amongst the consultants as the missing tooth, because when I show you the rest of the areas and the lots that are existing nonconforming or otherwise constrained, it shows that very fact that this is very consistent with the neighborhood and is not creating any kind of impact on that. The next map, I think, is probably the most important map here. And what we did essentially is through GIS information, we've taken essentially the neighborhood, so it's Alden Road and Winthrop, Seven Bridges Road, too, looked at the lots, most of which were in the original 1938 subdivision. And what you're seeing here is you're seeing the Kitts lots, which is at the corner there in the yellow. Those are identifying Lot 15 and Lot 5 in Alden. And is showing the balance of the lots that are in the immediate vicinity that are actually existing nonconforming. So as our attorney had indicated, most of the lots are at that, other than at the corners of the various roadways, are at that point 8-2. What that's done is created a number of lots because of that change in the regulations rendering these existing nonconforming. Now, what we've also done is indicated on Winthrop, so that's on the east side of Winthrop. There are also lots that are immediately adjacent to this property across the street from Winthrop. And I would also, and what we added to this is the buildability in terms of its compatibility. So although those lots all along Winthrop, again, immediately adjacent to and beyond, are lots that are of sufficient size, they are lots that are highly constrained because they back up to a DEC wetland. So what we also analyzed there for consistency is to show the buildability of the lots. So whatever you put on these lots, whether by code or by variance too, that whatever you can put on here is constrained on those lots that are not existing nonconforming. So again, the blue area is the DEC wetland, and what you would find as even those lots that are across the road on Winthrop from the subject lot, those lots actually have less developable area than the lots that we're talking about now. Again, because of setback requirements and DEC requirements and the environmental.
Do you know how there could be this confusion about a brook and a brook emptying into wetlands?
Well, we've looked at that. First of all, what we've done is we did a new survey of the property, so we looked at all the environmental features on the property. We saw no evidence of any streams on this property. Topo is pretty straightforward, graded from back to front, so it drains through the property, but there's no signs of anything. And then walking the property, we never came up with that, too. We do know that in conjunction with the wetland across the street, there are some streams on that side, too. They show up on the GIS mapping. So we looked at that, but there's no evidence of any streams on this property. So again, this was the new subdivision map on the property. We looked at all the features of the property, some of which were already analyzed. You saw in an earlier drawing that was prepared by the Kitts family had arranged for septic testing. There's actually a house designed for this property based on the current code, what could be built, so on and so forth. So what we did is we took the house design for purpose of the comparison. So you see the Alden Road lot and you see the Winthrop lot on there too. The way that that has been designed, and it met the health department requirements for the septic system is in the back with plenty of room for expansion. There's a stormwater system proposed for the front of that. We know even that the soils are good because they've been thoroughly tested on this property for compatibility to make sure that you could put an ample septic system on this property. And what you see is a fairly orderly development of this property, meeting all of the requirements. The only requirement, bulk requirement, that it does not meet, nor the one on Alden, is the gross area of that. They are insufficient based on previous changes in the zoning. So we provided a table of land use. I won't go into the specifics of that, but we provide a table of land use which analyzed that's in your packets. So for brevity, we have confirmed that it'd be fully compliant with that exception. As Deborah Kitts had indicated, again, it's an undeveloped lot. There was really no attempt to develop this at any point other than the current attempt starting in January. So the next slide that will show, go to the next one. Okay. So we were also looking at an alternative, what we call the merged lot alternative or a single lot plan too. The purpose of this is obviously with the larger lot it could be developed. What it does, in my opinion, is that it presents a lot that's developed with larger FARs, the ability for amenities on this property, which I will tell you, when you look at the overall map of this area, is inconsistent with this. I think the orderly development of this as proposed with the subdivision limits some of the amenities most of the amenities that you would put on, which you don't see on the other lots, that this would be a case where it'd be more inconsistent with the neighborhood, and I think your comprehensive plan looks at development to try to sustain these neighborhoods in the character that they're set up to be. And I think that the earlier map that we showed in terms of the subdivision consistency, and if you go to the next slide, really clearly shows that too. So we think that this is more in character, and in fact, we had an architect who was involved in the project at the time. So we go to the next one, Rich.
I see the architectural renderings.
Yes. So in terms of general character, too, they've even gone so far as having an architectural drawing. This is what they're looking at for a potential house. Again, staying well in character with that neighborhood, both size, dimensionally, height, and so on, would fully comply with the requirements. So next slide. We were also asked to look briefly at the fiscal impact, to look at the possible benefit to the community. The current taxes were analyzed on the property based on the information provided by the assessor's office on the tax rolls. Go to the next one, Rich. Based on the values of that, the current property taxes for the property, and it's both properties combined, is $22,000 a year, as opposed to the redevelopment as we had intended, which is the two-lot scenario, which increases the taxes threefold on the property. So we do think that there's a net benefit from a fiscal impact on the development of this property. And next slide. So again, coming back to this particular slide, we feel that the development, when you look at the houses and how the houses are organized, the amount of amenities on the property, there's very few of these properties that can be developed further than what they are. They all meet the current zoning code. That's what we're intending on doing here. Simply putting a single house on there with a septic, an approvable septic system, storm drains, and so on, which again stays in character with this neighborhood. So in terms of the tests, we're comfortable that there's no undesirable change produced as a result of development. So should a variance be granted by whatever means, this board seems reasonable and applicable. There is no undesirable change to the neighborhood. It is very consistent with the neighborhood and not a detriment. The benefits sought by the applicant cannot be achieved by any other method. It's an undeveloped parcel in our mind, and that the only avenue was to seek the variance that we're asking for. Whether it's substantial or not, it could be considered numerically substantial, I suppose, but again, you have to weigh that against the consistency of the neighborhood and what we're trying to do here. It's not an overdevelopment of this property. It's not a massive house. It's within the code requirements for all of the applicable regulations, coverage, and building footprint, gross development area. This is a variance, again, that we don't believe impacts the physical features of the property. We've had a chance to walk this property, understand what it looks like and how it could be developed successfully. And an unusual situation, number five, whether this was self-created, it's rare that I appear before a zoning board. Most variances are self-created where they have a setback or another issue that they want to increase the size of the properties or the house on a property. In this case, we were really subject to changes that occurred as a result of municipal action and changes in the code. One other point that I would make on this, too, is that there was a variance on 1 Lawrence. So if you can go back to the original on that, too. So 1 Lawrence is one of those lots that's existing nonconforming, and there was a zoning board decision to grant a variance on that. We know that the zoning change, you asked about the timing, whether it was in the 40s, that variance was granted in 1957 for a lot, allowing the building on that lot, and it was allowed, and I have that and I can submit that to the board, but was allowed because this was an existing nonconforming condition. And they permitted that building to go there, too. And that building is on that lot, and I think it was built shortly after that. So, and I'm here if any questions should come up. So.
I would simply conclude the application of the merger statute will cause an extreme hardship. It's, in effect, it's an arcane provision. It's gotcha law that even the town assessor was evidently not aware of, because he told the Kitzes they could build, they could sell both properties. It could have been avoided if the owners had been aware of the need to keep the property in separate names. And this board has an opportunity to address that injustice. And we would suggest they do so by choosing one of our alternatives, preferably one of the first three alternatives, or all three. Thank you.
Thank you. The board has received a number of different letters from neighbors about this issue. Is there anyone in the audience who wishes to be heard? Subject, yes.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman and members of the board. Brad Schwartz from the same problem with the other gentleman, Mr. Kitz. Brad Schwartz from Zarin and Steinmetz, representing Jane and Stephen Scheinfeld from 10 Winthrop. I'm here with the Scheinfelds and their professional engineer, Peter Gregory. I also have a PowerPoint that I'd like to. Do you want to exit your?
I'm sorry.
Okay, thank you for the time while we loaded that. Just so the board knows, I'm also working on this matter with co-counsel Mr. Cliff Davis Esquire, who couldn't be here tonight. So as some of the neighbor letters comment, they asked for the hearing to be adjourned, carried over until next month. Mr. Davis also could be here next month to comment on some of the issues that were raised tonight and in the application. I'm here primarily to discuss some of the legal merger-related questions and issues that are that have come up in this application. And I'll be happy also to put my comments in writing following tonight's meeting. When the Scheinfelds first learned that the wooded portion of this property was being marketed separately, they came to me to ask me to look at these issues and to analyze this matter, to make sure all the proper town processes were being followed. Like every development application that gets processed in this town, your board, when applicable, the planning board, has an opportunity to thoroughly review and vet all the issues. Here, the applicant appears to have tried to avoid those processes, right? First, the applicant went to the tax assessor to try to restore these 1938 lots back to the original 1938 subdivision. We all know the tax assessor doesn't have the power, right, to restore those lots as they were shown on the 1938 subdivision map. That's for the planning board to do. It was probably an error that was unintentional, but the tax assessor doesn't have that authority.
You're saying that the tax assessor doesn't have the authority? Did he have the authority to merge lots into one tax?
No, that's the planning board. So the merger is statutory, and to undo the merger is within the jurisdiction of the planning board.
So, but he was taxing it as one lot.
Mm-hmm.
What gave him that authority?
It was merged.
It was merged.
Merged pursuant to what?
Pursuant to that statutory requirement.
Which statute?
The code, the provision that was up on the screen before.
The tax assessor can interpret the merger statute without any hearing or anything else and just make it a zoning lot?
No, I'm suggesting not. For tax purposes, what the tax assessor was doing was totally separate. For zoning purposes, the two lots merged by operation of law. And so the building inspector we submit absolutely made the right determination here. When the kids applied for the building permit in June, the building inspector made the correct determination to deny that permit because the two lots had merged. And we submit that the correct outcome here is that the kids should be required to make the proper application to the planning board for preliminary subdivision approval, and at such time that the planning board then refers it back to your board for two area variances for the two substandard lots if they wish to proceed. Right? Every application that I've processed before this town that involves both planning board and zoning board approvals, typically you start at the planning board. Right? The planning board, you know, will have input on where the division line is, how the lots are laid out, and that application would advance to a certain extent. And when the planning board is comfortable with the overall site layout, we refer it back to your board for the area variances. And that's how we assume that the process should play out here because of the merger. The building inspector did the right thing by denying the building permit application. And I'd like to address some of the merger legal claims that were raised this evening. And I'll first start by the L-shape exception. That exception absolutely does not apply here. We're all familiar with the two lots on the 1938 subdivision map. These are clearly side by side. They're not L-shaped. The only L-shape is arguably the shape of the roads, but it's not an L-road shape exception, right? It's the shape of the lots. The applicant cited a couple of L-shape exception cases in its brief. We went and pulled the maps to correlate to those cases to show how those lots are configured, right? Picture's worth 1,000 words. I'd like to just present those maps from each of those cases. Peter, the first slide. So this is the Blue Ridge Gardens case that was cited in their brief. Clearly L-shape, right? The L-shape exception applies when a rear boundary line and a side boundary line is in common, but not along the entire length, right? That's what forms the L-shape. So in this case, 105 feet common boundary, but it's not coterminous, right? The common boundary is not along the entire length of lot 71. That's clearly an L-shape. And in this case, Blue Ridge, there was found to be no merger, right? The exception applied, L-shape. Peter, go back to our subdivision map. you could see the difference. Fast forward, Peter, to the Creamer map. Here we are again, L-shaped lots. Very different configuration to what we have here in our subdivision plat from 1938. In the Creamer decision, the lots were deemed not to have merged. The exception applied, right? But again, I'm distinguishing these cases where the exception applies to the facts here where they're side by side, not L-shaped.
These are both Supreme Court cases?
This is Supreme Court, 1959. Peter, Blue Ridge was appellate division, second department. I think that was a recent one, 1990. Go back for a second. Oh, that was 1974, second department.
No appeals taken?
Well, this was an appeal of 1974. I don't know if it went up to the Court of Appeals, but this is the
did you shepherdize?
Yes. So go to the third case now. Wiggin versus Kern. Again, another case cited by the applicant because it references the L-shaped exception. But in that case, the Second Department, this was the 1990 case I was thinking of, the Second Department found that the lots did, in fact, merge. And here we have, right, this is fronting on Aspen. Here's the deck. This is the rear. Here's the side. And it shares the common boundary along the entire length. And note, this is a corner lot, just like the situation here. What the applicant has tried to do is take an L-shaped exception and transform it to a corner lot exception. There is no corner lot exception in the code, in the law. The back-to-back exception, that's for two lots that are back-to-back on parallel streets, right? Backyard to backyard, the fronts are on two parallel streets. That's also clearly not the configuration here. So, bottom line, the L-shaped exception, the back-to-back exception does not apply here, and here are the pictures to prove that, and I'll submit these for the record. The second, a lot of attention was focused on the language of the statute, right, and how to interpret it in a fair and reasonable manner. No surprise, I have a different interpretation, okay? If the lot was not in separate ownership, which it wasn't, such other lot, and such other lot here is 5 Alden, such other lot, comma, or so much thereof as may be necessary, shall be combined. In our situation here, there's two substandard lots. So to make one or more non-conforming lots, you take the such other lot, which is 5 Alden, and you combine it in its entirety with the substandard lot next door. Peter, go to the subdivision map. Right. Substandard 0.6, substandard 0.8. Such other lot, which is lot 14, or so much thereof as may be necessary, shall be combined. If this was 1.2 acres, that's when the so much as necessary kicks in. You could take 0.2 of an oversized lot, combine it with a 0.82 here, and then now you have one or more conforming lots. You have two conforming lots. Because this would have been oversized, so you have one conforming oversized lot, one substandard lot. That's when the so much thereof is maybe necessary applies. That's not the case here.
I don't see that. The way I see it is that if you take what was written there and you do what it says to do, it's giving you permission to make a substandard lot even more substandard in order to make another substandard lot meet the code.
But that's not the correct outcome.
That's the way I see it.
You wouldn't read a code to allow a substandard lot to become even more substandard. So it's, again, there's an or in the statute. Such other lot, the entirety, or so much thereof as may be necessary, shall be combined.
And why is it necessary in your view?
Here, there's so much as shall be necessary does not apply because you have two substandard lots.
Well, why would it be necessary if lot 15 is legal non-conforming? Why is it necessary to add anything to it?
Under the statutory merger provision, it's not a legal non-conforming lot. It's merged with lot 14.
Whoops. Says who?
Says your code. But if we could put up the statutory language. Jim, can I use your...
Here. Sorry. Let's close this out.
I'll just use this paper.
If the lot was not in separate ownership, such other lot, right, such other lot is 5 Alden, the improved lot, that's .6, comma, or so much thereof as may be necessary. What I submit is that there's various scenarios where a merger applies. Side-by-side lots, you could have both substandard or only one substandard, right? A merger kicks in, a merger applies when you have at least one substandard lot. You could have one next to a conforming lot, or you could have two substandard lots. If you have one conforming lot and one substandard lot, right, and that conforming lot is oversized, then you could take so much thereof as the oversized conforming lot, add to the substandard lot, and create one or more conforming lots. That's not the scenario here. Here we have two lots that are side by side, again, common ownership, so merger applies, that are both substandard, a 0.6 and a 0.8. So we don't pay attention to the, or so much thereof as may be necessary. We focus on such other lot. Such other lot shall, it's mandatory, statutory, mandatory operation by law, shall be combined with the first name lot to make one or more conforming.
And where does it say that they're merged?
Shall be combined. This is a merger provision. And it may not use the word merger, but your building inspector certainly interpreted it as a merger provision. The applicant's attorney tonight called it a merger provision. We all know the merger doctrine, right? It's a well-established principle. I'll go back to the microphone in land use and zoning, right? When there are side-by-side lots.
Brad, isn't this the provision that creates the merger?
Exactly. So now I submit the merger occurred. The lots are now one. And so the only way to undo the merger, as the applicant is suggesting, is not by the tax assessor, not by the building inspector.
You said the planning lots are now one. What made them one?
The lots were not in separate ownership. We heard from the applicant tonight, if only I knew better, we would have put them in separate ownership, but they didn't. So the lots were in common ownership.
If the lot was
not,
was
in, separate
not in separate ownership.
But it was in separate ownership.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it was.
It was.
But it's saying, now where does it say if it is in separate, if it is in common ownership, it's merged? Where does it say that in the statute?
Shall be combined.
No, it says if the lot was not in separate ownership. Okay.
The lot was owned by in common.
They were
the
in one common.
That so means it was owned by in common.
Such other lot, or so much thereof as may be necessary, shall be combined. So what was combined?
If 5 Alden, which is the such other lot, is combined with the first name lot. The first name lot is the substandard wooded portion.
So you're saying nothing was necessary. So the clause that says, or so much thereof as may be necessary,
because one
doesn't apply?
Not in this scenario.
Not
it
in
could,
this scenario.
It could apply if there was an oversized conforming lot adjacent to a substandard lot. Right? For argument's sake.
How would one reading the statute know that?
Statutory interpretation is...
If you're
you get,
a property
you get,
owner and you want to buy a piece of property in Chappaqua, how would you know what you're saying now? Would I have to hire an attorney to... It sounds like this is an extremely ambiguous statute.
I respectfully disagree and submit that it's pretty clear that when it's not in separate ownership, meaning it's in common ownership as we have here, either the entirety of the lot or a portion shall be combined. Look, every town has, most towns, right, has merger provisions. And the case law is clear, it was cited by the applicant. Merger only applies if the statute provides for it. So most communities have a statute provision, statutory provision. And it's automatic, it's by operation of law. The tax assessor doesn't apply it, the building inspector doesn't apply it. It's applied by the code. And so when there's two lots next to each other,
in the same ownership. And every community, it's the same principle. The words may be a little different. It's the same principle. Two lots, common ownership, at least one of which is substandard, they merge. Either they merge totally together to form one large lot, or, as Newcastle has allowed, that if one of the lots is a conforming, oversized lot, you don't have to merge the entirety. You could take just a portion as may be necessary. So
he doesn't say if one lot is oversized and one is not. It's, to me, and I'm not an attorney or anything, I'm trying to figure this out as everybody's explaining it. But to me, it shall be merged, right. But they're giving you a choice. You can either merge the two if you so choose, or you could take some from one and give it to the other if you so choose. If you do that, what you're doing is making a conforming lot and a substantially non-conforming lot. And that's the way I'm reading it. And I think they wrote it wrong. I think it was a terrible thing the way it was worded, and we're all stuck with it. And we got to figure a way out of this.
And so I would submit that to interpret this, to take 0.2 of the substandard lot and make it even more substandard, that is the unreasonable outcome, right? Principles of statutory interpretation and construction under New York law, you read the statute as a whole, you give it a reasonable outcome. And so here, Newcastle has allowed again for two scenarios. Either the entirety of the lot or a portion, whatever's necessary. So if 5 Alden, again, respectfully, was 1.2 acres, you could take 0.2 from 5 Alden, add it to the 0.8, and have two conforming lots.
But it doesn't say either the entirety of the lot or if such second lot...
Such other lot.
Okay, right. But it doesn't say that if the next lot is oversized, you can take it away, and it doesn't say you can't. It doesn't say that. And that's what's wrong with this thing. The wording is so ambiguous here as to be totally confusing.
So it's the language that's in the code. It's the language that we're all stuck with interpreting, right? The applicant, the neighbors, as well as the zoning board. And the building inspector, frankly, is the first arbiter of zoning, as you all know, in the town. The building inspector made a decision that based on this language, his interpretation was the merger applies. And I would submit that to interpret the code in a way that you take land from 5 Alden and make it even more nonconforming, especially when you look at the subdivision provisions in the code, right? You can't subdivide a property that has an existing building in such a way as to make it, render it nonconforming. So that would be an unreasonable interpretation or application of the statute.
I agree to that part. Yeah. What I'm trying to say is that it's wrong. The whole thing is wrong. It's not fair to the residents of the town and the prospective new residents of the town who are looking to build in this town. I think that this whole the wording there is unfair to the applicant and unfair to the people who are opposed to this situation, and
there are
somehow
some,
we have to rectify that.
There are some statutes that work under some circumstances, and they don't work when applied under other circumstances. So it doesn't mean the statute is necessarily bad or unconstitutional, but its application under certain factual scenarios can be bad, and courts have so ruled in those cases.
You're here this evening because you want to send this to the planning board, right? You want the applicant to go through what, in your estimation, are the correct channels to achieve a subdivision.
That's correct.
Right? Okay. What else do we need to say on this matter at this point in time?
And one of the reasons why, and I want Peter to spend a couple of minutes to highlight it.
Okay.
Again, development applications go through the normal review processes. And just to, I want to just address something that you said.
Sure.
This is not about future owners buying land, right? This is a non-conforming. The policy in New York is to eliminate non-conforming and bring all land into conformance. So this does, statutory merger does deal with older lots that were substandard that have not been developed for decades. In this instance, because frankly, you heard it tonight, they liked having their wooded enclave on the corner, and they chose not to develop it for decades, and now they're seeking to. But the statutory merger provision doesn't allow them to do it without going to the planning board and your board for two area variances, and the building inspector got that determination right. And Peter could highlight a couple of issues with septic, just to touch upon why it's so important to make sure that these lots go through the proper review processes, so therefore the planning board, the town engineer, everyone has an opportunity to weigh in. Because there are some real septic issues here that need to be vetted during the public review process.
Wasn't this property subdivided once?
back in 1938.
Yeah. So was that an appropriate subdivision?
That subdivision was lawful, yes.
So if it never changed from that, if there was no merger, then that subdivision would still apply. You wouldn't have to go to the planning board, would you?
Not now, but then at the time to develop that lot, that building lot that was shown on a filed subdivision plat, you would have had to go through DOH and all the processes to get all your approvals. Now, decades later, almost 100 years later, the lot's merged. And to undo the merger.
Wait, they still have to go to the DOH for septic. We don't have anything to do with septic. That's Department of Health, Westchester County.
But to undo the merger, the only board has the power to now undo the statutory merger is the planning board.
Let's hear about the septic. Again, my name is Peter Gregory. I'm with Keene Compliment Gregory Engineers in Mount Kisco. And the purpose of my review was to look just at septic and stormwater. And we've heard a lot of discussion tonight about the viability of developing Lot 15. But most of my focus is dealing with 5 Walden and some of the issues that are coming up based on what we've seen in our review of building department records and health department records and how it applies to 5 Walden and some of the issues that have come up. When the house was initially constructed back in 1940, the house was approved as a 2-bedroom dwelling. And based on the information that was submitted to the town, that existing septic system appears to have been depicted, it's not going to show on there, but in the lower, I guess I'm going to call it the southern portion of the property. Consistent with health department records, a small, what I'm going to say today is undersized based on today's standards, a small septic system, and an absorption system to support 2 bedrooms back when it was improved in 1940. The other concern that we have based on what we found in our review of the records is the use of the building. Building department records indicated that when the home was built, it was a 2-bedroom dwelling. Footprint and garage consistent with what we're seeing today. What we're noticing that's being represented today is that there's a room on the second floor of the crossing over between the garage and the main portion of the building. We're not able to go into the property. We weren't able to investigate the septic system. But one of the concerns that we have that based on the age of the system, almost 80 years old, potential buyers are going to probably put into a position at some point in time that they're going to have to repair or replace that existing system. We're also looking into what are the number of bedrooms that are actually Why is that important today?
Well, because if this is not reviewed, that triggers a septic review from the Helper with just the vacant piece, Lot 15, no consideration is being given to what is going to occur on 5 Walden Road. Subdivision review would trigger health department review to find a potential replacement area for that system.
Okay. If I could just jump in for a second,
sure.
To cut to the chase, right? The issue is to just simply restore to how it was in 1938 may not be viable because there's a chance, right, depending upon the outcome to some of the questions that Peter's raising, that some portion of the wooded area is needed to support septic for a 4-bedroom home on 5 Alden.
The plan is representing that there's a 100% expansion area on the property, which would be an area to place. But in 1940, when this was approved and constructed, the health department did not require expansion areas at that time. And if we were to look at this today, based on its proximity to the drainage, that's the catch basin in the street, that lower area fronting on Winthrop would not be permitted to be considered a replacement. We'd have to look somewhere else on the property. And we also have some question as to how is the space that was created subsequent to the construction in 1940, how is that space being used? Our review or our research indicated there weren't any permits or any work that was done that would have triggered health department review to address the septic system. However, what's been brought to our attention is that when that property was listed and marketed, it was in some places listed as a 4-bedroom dwelling or even lived like a 4-bedroom dwelling. We're recognizing where the system is, what the location is, what the age of it was, But what we don't know is what actually was created that may have given that feeling. Some of the photographs that we have that show possibly, you know, does show that space on the second floor being finished, which could be possibly an additional bedroom, a third bedroom or a fourth bedroom.
Slide. Show the...
So there is space that's finished on the second floor. So basically,
I'm sorry. What are we looking at that you think could be a bedroom?
Well, there's just additional space that's finished between the first floor and a small area in the second floor. I believe the picture to the upper left might be the finished space. But in any event, there was information that was submitted that refers to living space on the second floor. We would like to see additional information that maybe shows some architectural floor plan layouts that indicate how the space is being used, what the rooms are, and also maybe address septic 4-5 Alden, as well as lot 15.
But the point of all this is these are the kinds of issues that would get totally flushed out of bed.
I understood. We heard it. Yep, we got it. You're finished with your... Yes. Who else would like to speak to this matter? Yes.
Just regarding the septic system, we had fully inspected the existing septic system, reliable company. So we'll submit that to Mr. DePauli. He can take a look at that, too.
Okay.
So we're satisfied that we'd have no problems meeting the health department requirements for this house.
On Alden or the empty land?
Actually, on both. So we looked at the lot 15, the new lot. That was an approved septic system. Health department did a full detailed review with the percolation test, so on. The existing septic system, we had a company go out there, inspect that system, was satisfied that it's functioning properly. We had looked at the soil conditions around that area, and we believe if we had to meet current health department requirements, we can also do that, and we'll provide that information to you.
Do you know how many bedrooms there
There's
are?
Two.
There are two.
Yeah, I
two bedrooms. For the record, two bedrooms.
Okay.
And if I may, as the property, my firm represented the Kids Estate when they were selling 5 Alden, and the question came up, is it a legal 2-bedroom, 3-bedroom, or 4-bedroom? We determined that, in fact, it's a legal 2-bedroom. It was sold as a legal 2-bedroom. It has never been used as a 4-bedroom. The only people living there were Mr. and the elder Kitzes,
right.
And the purchasers bought it, and the selling price was substantially less because it was sold as a 2-bedroom house.
I'm sorry, on that point, go ahead.
The Department of Health has reviewed the septic plan for the new...
Yes, and approved it.
And approved it.
Yes.
Do you have a reaction to council's suggestion that this should be directed to the planning board?
I do. I don't think it's necessary because I think the issue that we've raised is the enforceability of the merger statute. We only go to the zoning, to the planning board if the two properties have merged. Mr. Schwartz is a reasonable person. He espoused a reasonable interpretation, and I think I'm a reasonable person, and I espoused a reasonable interpretation, and the very definition of ambiguity is if there are more than one reasonable interpretations of a statute. What is clear is it's ambiguous.
Okay.
And if it's ambiguous, I don't think you can apply it.
Thank you. So, Eric, you as counsel need some time to
We're reviewing the legal issues. We've heard from both sides tonight with respect, and the board's heard with respect for, you know, the interpretation issues and some of the other legal issues. We'll provide the board with our legal analysis. I believe, you know, there's other counsel that may want to submit some documentation on behalf of the neighbors on this, is what my understanding is. So my recommendation would be to hold the public hearing open until the next meeting when you have our legal advice and you can get the final, any other submissions from both sides that want to be made, and then the board can choose to proceed at the next meeting.
So I move that... we hold the public hearing open, continue the matter to next month. During that time period, we will be open to receiving submissions from the public, and we will also hear from the board's counsel.
I'll second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Del Rempel?
Hi, I'm Mary Scott, representing the Del Rempels this evening. You're here to ask for a side yard setback variance in order to extend a patio with a low ceiling wall. Del Rempel's home is on Northbridge Place. It's a rather large property. I mean, it's over an acre, but it slopes down the entire way down to Seven Bridges Road. So it leaves very little space for outdoor living. What we've done is we have a deck on the lower level, which is really outside their basement, with a patio. And what they would like to do is extend the patio with a low sitting wall and a fire pit. So I drew this. So we're talking about a wall that's 2 feet high. These are the neighbors. It's going to take up a very unused corner of the property, which is kind of desolate looking. The other part of the variance is building a fence around their AC equipment and oil tank, which is quite ugly. There is a letter from the neighbor in support of the application. And we feel it's not going to be very impactful. As I say, the wall is this high. So.
That's the oil tank for the home. How many gallons is that?
It's pretty big. Yeah, no, I think they're going to replace it, move it closer to the house, and put it in the fence because it really
looks smaller than 500.
Oh, really? What, you tell me. I'm sorry. I thought it looked big.
275.
275. Okay.
Which speaking neighbor? Of numbers, Mary, the usual suspects. I'll take care of it.
Which neighbor has written an approval?
This one.
The one that's
the one
right.
Most
important. Right. The one that's right across.
Right.
Is there anyone in the audience who wishes to speak to this application? No. Good here. I move that we close the public hearing.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Would you like to make a motion?
The application of Christopher Dalrymple, I move that we approve the variance for 18 feet side yard.
17 feet side yard, so it's an 18-foot variance, yes.
So we need 18 feet.
For a variance, yes.
18-foot side yard.
Sorry.
Is that what I say?
Yeah, it's just the side yard is going to be 17, so.
Side yard 17, the variance is 18 feet.
Right.
Yeah.
35.
Correct.
So let's go back.
It's a confusing night.
We're all having sleep, I think.
To expand the patio and add a fire pit and a 2-foot-high sitting wall. Following reasons, the granting of variance will not create an undesirable change in the character of the neighborhood. No feasible method other than the variance to achieve the benefit that the applicant is seeking. The variance is substantial. However, we're talking about a patio and a 2-foot-high wall, which is not a large structure. There'd be no adverse effect or impact on the physical or environment conditions in the neighborhood. It is a self-created hardship, de minimis, and the most affected neighbor has written to the board and expressed their approval for the project. Based upon that, I move that we grant the 18-foot side yard variance. 6 months to start, 1 year to finish.
Survey, please.
Survey.
I'll second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Thank you. Happy variance.
Enjoy.
Mozuki.
Good evening.
Hi.
Good afternoon, or good evening, I should say. I'm representing the Bazzutis. And we're looking for an additional area for parking cars, which you can see is up there. Because of the front, it's closer to the front, so we need a variance for the parking because it's 20 feet off the front. Zoning requires for parking right now, of course, but we don't have it, and therefore it's reduced a certain amount for the parking. And then now the interpretation is for retaining walls. We're moving a wood retaining wall. We're going to put more rock so that it'll match up with the rest. It'll look nice. And since we're moving that and we're within a certain distance to the property line, we got to get a variance for the side and a variance for the front, where we're putting the new wall, not where the old wall is, but where the new wall is going. So we're asking for three different variances here now, and that's what I've represented.
Why is the why are these additional parking spaces necessary?
Basically, they like, if they can, they try to pull out straight ahead and not back out into the road. And to do that, they have to move when they have more friends over and stuff like that. They end up, it's a very narrow driveway. It has a wall on either side. And this will give them that little extra room. The house itself doesn't really have a garage, so it's two cars parking up at the top. Yeah, so that's why they're doing it. And there's a fence along one side, which is blocking it from the neighbor next door completely. So this work won't even be seen.
I have a question on measurement.
Sure.
On Tom's denial letter, in your front yard, he's showing a proposed setback of 12 feet, but on your plan it shows 10 feet.
Yeah, well, it's just when it was drawn, it was 10 feet for the front yard setback because of the new retaining wall, but 20 feet for the parking because that's where it just comes back. We come back on an angle rather than straight.
No, I understand that. Yeah. We have to use either your 10-foot measurement or Tom's 12-foot measurement.
We came out to a nice 10 feet. You want to call it 12? We can just tip that up a little.
Just
10 is what it came out to.
We just don't want to make a...
The dimensions were not scaled.
Oh, okay. I'm not just want to use the right number. I would go and use the 10 so you...
We can go
so
with
that
10.
You're covered.
That would be fine.
You know, is that okay with you, Tom?
Please, thank you.
Okay.
Would you say this is based on a safety request? I mean, I know hard gravel is a...
They just don't want to back out into the street. This gives them that extra room so they can do a little bit of maneuvering in their driveway before they try to come out. Because right now, if they're parked up at the top and somebody parks right behind them, you can't back over on the grass a little bit or anything else because there's a little bit of a retaining wall on either side.
Right.
So there's no way to move around. This gives them that little extra room that... Not a lot, but a little extra room.
Make it safe.
Yeah.
Is there anyone in the audience who wishes to speak to this application?
Can I just, I'm the property owner. I just wanted to speak a little bit to safety.
Sure.
So being on Hartsgravel, I'm Joseph Pizzuti, property owner from 912 Hartsgravel. We kind of, you know, we're not trying to blow up our house or anything. We just want some additional room for parking being on hardscrabble, it's kind of a main road, and particularly where we are in either direction, as you go out, there's kind of a bend and sort of blind spot, so we want to limit the need to back out, and obviously there's no street parking there. The only option is to park on Douglas or Douglas Extension north. So, you know, that would involve, you know, walking often, you know, with friends, families, with kids, so we want to avoid, you know, them walking on that area with the blind spots. You know, the existing wall is wood rotting railroad ties that needs to be replaced. We want to take this opportunity to essentially just make, you know, it safer since we have to, you know, resurface the driveway anyway.
Okay.
Thanks for your consideration.
Thank you.
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman, there is the one gentleman that wanted to speak on this.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes.
Yes, my name is Ivan Haller, and my wife and myself are owners of the property facing their property on Harscarborough Road.
Okay.
And there are, let me first say that there is, we have met Mr. and Mrs. Bizzuti, as a matter of fact, as they offered help to me when I was shoveling snow, and I don't know, you know, and,
sure.
I'm just,
so what's
now, I didn't remember the name.
So you have some reaction.
Anyway,
so you have some.
We are neighbors,
okay.
And we certainly want to resolve this issue in a way that is the most advantageous for everybody. Now, unfortunately, there's another complication, and that is the involvement of the town. Because I had some consultation with Mr. Campbell relating possible changes renovations or subdivisions possibly.
Yes, but
made.
Could I just, I'm sorry, I don't mean to interrupt, but respectfully, could you tell us about this application? That matter, that other matter,
yes,
isn't before
this application
us.
Is relevant to some other plans that we have explored, and they are on in pendants. So it is relevant. The other issue is who can represent us legally, and I there I can accept your opinion here, if it is put in binding, namely that Mr. Campbell, with whom I did have a consultation in the past, and knows a lot about the issues that that my property has, can he legally represent two parties now and two parties properly in the future.
Yes, sir. So these are two separate matters, and yes, Mr. Campbell can represent this applicant. So tell us what your, if you have one, what your objection is to what this applicant is seeking to accomplish.
That it is not the best interest in three different parties, theirs, ours, and the and town of Newcastle.
Okay, well, don't worry about the town. How is this impacting you adversely?
We have exactly the same issue as they do, and we have lived with it for 50 years.
Sure.
That because of the traffic on Hartscrabble Road,
it
requires us to bike back out our
We understand.
I'm sorry. Let me.
Okay.
Please let me explain.
Okay.
To continue the practice that we have been living with for 50 years of having to back our cars into a driveway for safety reasons, because if we had any one of the three vehicles sitting there in the back, it requires somebody to walk over
sure.
to the other side of the road
sure.
and, you know, and wave them out.
You know what I think?
What is your address?
So that's really objection, but my request for reconsideration is that I do not want to create a precedent where somebody could do it, and but they do not wish just like us,
okay.
you know, be allowed to allow that without us or our
right.
sons who might inherit the property.
I understand what you're saying, and it sounds like an unsafe condition, and I think it's something that you should explore. Maybe it's not with Mr. Campbell, maybe it's with someone else, but please, you know, consider doing that. In the meantime, we're going to... Yes, ma'am.
Can I just say something,
yes,
if I may?
Of course.
Yeah, she's my wife.
Okay.
What your address is, please? What is your address?
901 Hartscrabble.
901.
Yes. Our garage, the little one we have, is directly opposite their driveway. And several years ago, before they moved in, whoever was living there, they used to have people visit. So they had their daddy's car. So if they had four cars on the driveway, it was very dangerous. And one of those cars slipped. They were trying to back out.
Right.
Whatever happened, that car went directly and knocked down our complete garage. And luckily, no one was severely hurt.
So I think what you're telling us
is... So I really am concerned that would happen again.
So this is a good solution.
What?
What they're asking.
Because I asked them today. They never bothered to tell us that they're going to have work done, and we would have people on the road, which makes very dangerous driving, by the way, and whether we should have plugs out or whatever. But they plan to have at least four. If you have more than three cars there, it is still very dangerous.
Okay.
I guarantee.
Okay.
Maybe you should look.
Okay. I appreciate your comments.
I mean, it's dangerous.
I appreciate
they
that.
They drive like maniacs on Hartscrabble Road to start with.
I've observed that myself. Thank you.
Can I ask you a question? When you leave your driveway, do you back out onto their property?
When I leave the driveway, I don't drive anymore,
okay.
by the way.
Well, you did.
But what I did is I backed in the driveway.
Backed into what driveway?
Yes.
Into their driveway?
No. I backed into my driveway
into
very carefully so that I could back out.
So you don't need, You don't need their property to leave your property to get...
No, but I'm concerned that more car, if they continue to back out the way they do, it's still dangerous.
We're gonna address that.
I mean, I watched today in the driveway as I was leaving. They were up and down the driveway.
Okay.
Because there are many cars coming.
We appreciate the fact that you came.
So to have 3 to 5 cars there.
So it seems.
I mean, can you contain the amount of cars that are? I mean, because no one says, well, we'll park so many cars there.
Well, part of what they were saying was they have children and other parents come to
yes.
drop off children and so forth.
Well,
so
it was a parent with a child that caused us all that heart. Okay. But I wanted to explain that.
We have lived with those conditions for 50 years.
Okay. I understand.
You know,
yep.
So I am concerned about creating a precedent that will...
We're trying to ameliorate the situation, though.
Yes,
okay.
And that is exactly what I would like to see. That,
okay. Thank you very much. We have to move
in
on.
In
okay?
your consideration of approval, please keep in mind unless it is some way in the language or whatever, in the language of the approval.
Okay.
What we're doing tonight, sir, is not going to injure you, and it's not going to prevent you from taking other actions in the future if you so choose to. So for right now, we have to move on. Okay. Thank you very much for coming down. Thank you. I'd like to close. I'm sorry, is there someone else who wants to speak to this? No. I'd like to close the public hearing.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Who'd like to make a motion?
I move that we approve the application of Joseph Bizzuti of 912 Hardscrabble for the for the purpose of constructing a retaining wall and parking area to increase parking at the subject location. This will require a front yard setback of
50 feet.
Reduced from 60 to 48 feet.
10 feet.
Okay. A side yard setback reduced from 35 to 10 feet.
Yeah, those because the retaining.
And an off-street parking 30-foot setback reduced to 12 feet. For the following reasons. The applicant has demonstrated that the purpose for the changes will benefit the safety and improve the ability of the property to accept cars and ingress and egress from the property more easily. The only neighbor that appeared in opposition did not have any relevant objections, but appears to be in a similar situation. The granting of the variance will not create an undesirable change or character to the neighborhood. No other feasible method is available to the applicant, which is likely to achieve the benefit that's being sought. The requested variances are not materially substantial considering the benefit that is being obtained from the granting of the variances. Proposed variances will not have an adverse effect or impact on the physical or environmental conditions of the property or the district. The applicant's difficulty or hardship is not self-created. reason that I moved that we approved the application. Tom, do you need any surveys?
Yes, please.
A survey upon
completion.
Upon completion. 6 months to start, a year to complete.
I'll second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. Happy Burns.
Excuse me, how long is it going to take to complete?
Next case is Singh.
That's all I'm saying, Tom.
Clear and understood.
Good evening. I'm Jerry Barrett. I'm the landscape architect, site planner for the project. I'm here with the applicant, Dr. Singh.
Before you start, I'm due to a conflict of interest, I'm recusing from this application. So before you start, thank you.
Just give me a second to try to get this. Again, I'm Jerry Barrett. I'm the landscape architect for the project. The applicant owner is Dr. Singh. This is a project on Heathcote Road. It's been before the planning board. Essentially, what this project is, and I'm not sure this is going to work here. I don't know why this doesn't work, but red does not work. So what you're seeing are there's two lots. There's a 2.6-acre lot in the back, and then there's a 2-acre lot in the front that fronts on Heathcote Drive. This application is to merge these two lots. It's a subdivision, but I guess you'd call it a merger, and then Dr. Singh would like to construct a new house on there. So we've been before the planning board, and we discussed the project with the planning board. And what was discussed with the planning board that, you know, it's a 4.5-acre lot, so it's a large lot. And in all respects, we can construct a zoning-compliant layout. However, the house would require an FAR variance. And as you know, it's interesting in that the one-acre zone, that the FAR is capped at about 7,700 square feet, while building coverage and development coverage are allowed to increase with the size of the lot. It's kind of an interesting arrangement. So what we've tried to do was try to create a layout for the property that would fit with the neighborhood, that would actually be a benefit to the neighborhood. This property historically has had a house on it, and the original house was going to be right in there. This is where the original house used to be. There used to be a garage right over here. Prior to Dr. Singh taking ownership, Tavo Development had proposed a house here, and that would have come before your board for an FAR variance as well. So we're proposing a house here, and what's interesting here is that we are straddling, this is the lot line between the two lots, the lot in the back and the lot in the front, and we're kind of straddling that line. So I'm going to try to be brief because I know the hour is late, and I know we have some issues that we have to continue to work on here. We did get a notice late this afternoon from Adriana that the neighbor to the west had provided and something to do with restrictive covenants. We're currently reviewing that with our attorney to see how that may apply to this project. I think in essence it says the development on the lots, and I believe it refers only to the back lot, should be compliant with the zoning regulations. And why we're here is to be compliant with the zoning regulations, but we need to look into that a little bit more. But in terms of the layout, a couple of things we'd like to point out is that, you know, we are about three times the front yard setback to where the house is. We're going to provide a very dense, we're going to keep as much existing planting as we can. We're going to be doing a lot of planting to provide a filtered view to the house. There's going to be a stone wall in the front, and the house is going to sit up on a rise. We've purposely positioned the house back. We didn't want to get it up close because we thought if we put the house in this area, it would kind of block the homes that are fronting on. So we thought it would kind of, you know, it kind of funnels you in and preserves the view down the street. What we've known in cross-section, just to give you an idea of what's happening, Heathcote Drive is here. The property rises up. The stone wall, this would be, you know, the vegetation that's there, all new vegetation, septic system in the back. In looking at it from the side, this would be the view from the street. What the planning board was concerned with was the relative proximity to the existing house to the east, I believe this is. Excuse me. And what we propose there is we note that we're a bit farther away than the previous applicant had proposed, the Tavo applicant. What we talked about was there is a lot of existing vegetation here, and maybe it's hard for you guys to see here, but this is all existing vegetation. All that's going to remain. We're going to put a 6-foot solid fence on the property line. Then we're going to create a very dense hedgerow in this area. And then it's going to be protected space. We're going to have monuments every 50 feet, and that will be a restriction that will run with the land, that can never be converted. Can never be converted to grass. So the idea is to keep that buffer there. We think what's interesting about this property is that. Okay, so this is Heathcote here, and what this slide is trying to show that this is the home that where the buffer is to the east, and we're about 140 some odd feet. We're 500 feet from the house to the west. We're 400 to 500 feet here, 300 feet or so here. So we're quite a ways distance from other homes in the neighborhood. And the other thing that I think is interesting about this site is that. To the back of this site, it's all wooded, and it's apparently protected space. From the proposed home to the west, it's all natural area. Looking directly across the street, it's a wooded wetland. So really, the only close home about 140 feet away is going to be this home. So I think that's significant that the property is kind of isolated. It doesn't really, it's not directly in view of any neighbor, so to speak. For many reasons, we think we have a good plan, but, we do have to investigate what's happening with this restrictive covenant that was brought up to us today, which we're still working on. And we also had the opportunity to speak with some of the neighbors on Heathcote Road who are here this evening. And they very nicely introduced themselves and explained their concerns to us. And their concern, I think, is about the size of the house and the architectural style of the house and whether that's going to fit into their neighborhood. And I think it's a valid concern. So Dr. Singh and I, we did discuss this with them. I think we'd like to have some more time to go back with the architect and see what we can do to try to make this blend into the neighborhood a little more to the satisfaction of the neighbors. Dr. Singh wants to be a good neighbor. So we're certainly willing to investigate that. And, we'll see what we can do to bring this in. It's just odd because we're seeking a variance for, I guess, the volume of the house or the interior space of the house, whereas the building code would actually let us build a bigger house. It's an interesting setup, but I think we need a little bit more time to go back and study this and work with the neighbors to see if we can come to an agreement that works for everybody.
Okay, thank you.
What is the reason for the increased size in the FAR. Why do you need all of that footage?
Well, I think that what it comes down to, in Dr. Singh's culture, the family lives together. For instance, Dr. Singh and his wife and their children. Dr. Singh's wife's parents live with them. Dr. Singh's parents will also be living with them. So in his culture, the family lives together.
How many square feet, how many bedrooms would you need for a house that size?
How many bedrooms are in the house, Doc?
4 bedrooms. I think there's one in the downstairs master bedroom.
I'm sorry, sir. Could you speak into the microphone for us? Thank you.
Yeah. There's one master bedroom downstairs, and one playroom, and 4 bedrooms are there upstairs. 4 bedrooms and 1 5 bedrooms.
And you need a house that is 9,000
yes.
square feet to
yes.
do that? For 4 bedroom house?
Yeah, for 5 bedroom, because it's all open space. We are making all open space, okay?
So the code only permits, what is it, 7,000? Could you not have
the only reason is this, when I bought the land from Travelodge, when I bought the land, those two lots can be merged, and I was explained and I was told that once the two lot becomes 4.6 acres, I will be allowed to build this house. So basically, it's an open space, and it's an open area we'd like to live in, and it's extended family.
I told you that. That's not what our zoning code says.
But once the two lots get merged, the FAR increases in size.
No, it's locked. That's the issue. It's locked.
With the 1 acre zone, right?
But we still are in 1 acre no matter what.
Okay.
Even though we have 4 times that, we're still in the 1 acre
zone. But that's why we are going to the variance to request that.
We don't generally give variances out unless there's a good reason for it.
We live with an extended family, with my kids, my families.
7,000 square foot house should be adequate for 4 bedroom family.
One for us, one for my father-in-law, 3 for kids. And then 1 prayer room and 1 guest room. That's what it is. Because that's why we divided it.
I would suggest you go back to the drawing board with your architect and see if you can find a house that's compliant with the FAR requirements that has the right number of bedrooms for yourself.
Well, in any event, you're going back and you're reviewing this.
We are reviewing it, yes.
There are other issues, and I think we have some members of the community that want to speak to this.
Sure.
Is there anyone here this evening who wishes to speak to this application? Sure. You don't have to.
Since I'm Greg Osland, I'm 1 Heathcote. We're actually east. We refer to the house as the west. We're on the east.
So you've written to us. We have your
correspondence. Right. So you have everything. I'm just
maybe you want to summarize what your reaction is to the application.
Sure. I was actually of the mind when I saw this and the fact that it was in consideration of a buffer zone that existed between Cowan Lane and Heathcote. There's a code restrictions that specifically state an agreement between Reader's Digest and the Flynn Corporation. That basically said any future building on the lot was going to be restricted to the existing zones and would not be eligible for variance consideration. So when I saw it, that there was a 30% increase in the variance consideration, I thought we really shouldn't be even having this discussion because it is covered in the restricted covenants. So that was the first part, that why we're even here. But what we're trying to protect here is When you look at there's been some big houses that have been put on Heathcote, they're very nice. The idea that we would need to have a 30% variance to build even a bigger house that, quite frankly, would be in our sight line, I would be more concerned if I was the house on the other side, because I could see the O'Neill's house for the last 17 years. So having something that was going to be twice as big as that was, obviously something that'd be concerned. But for us, because we have so much water runoff from the property, it flows into our pond. I sent some videos just to kind of give you an idea on any particular day. It is a very fragile ecosystem that exists between our house and Dr. Singh's house, and I just hope that the board would recognize that. I've seen that they've put a pretty extensive drainage in there, which is great, you know, awesome. But I would say right now, the video that you saw there, if there's no house, there's no driver, there's no nothing. So if you're going to put 17,000 square feet of coverage in that area, it's going to have very big ramifications and impact on the habitat in that area. I don't know if that's the zoning board, but
the character of the neighborhood?
Quite substantially, yes. You know, what was there with the O'Neills, obviously they had 10 acres and a 4,000 square foot house. So from that perspective, yes.
Are you going to see this house?
Oh, yeah. It's right across the pond. So there's a pond that sits between us. And
you're the brick house?
Yes, the red brick house on the corner. So, but again, I really didn't think we'd have to come to this level because there are strict covenants that specifically say this should not be an issue and should not be discussed. So that's why
we'll be looking into those.
Right. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks for your time.
Before we go, can I just yeah. say a couple,
sure.
just respond to a couple of points while it's fresh. So what we have here is the gentleman's house is here. And the proposed, this actually is the O'Neill house, and the Singh house would be in this area. This is about 500 feet. It is going through natural areas, wooded areas. So I think while yes, they will probably see the house, it is quite a distance off. But I think the main point I want to make is that, and we went through this a bit at the planning board meeting, that here is the pond. And the water is running perpendicular to the contour. So this runoff that's coming here is indeed going to the pond. However, we're not changing anything here. No trees are getting cut down. The water that's coming off of this development is all going to be captured in catch basins. And in the front yard here, there's a whole system of stormwater infiltrators. So as a result of this, this will be a code compliance system. We will not be increasing the volume or the rate of runoff, and it discharges in this area right here and then runs this way below the pond and gets into the catch basin. So it discharges to the same place the pond discharges. So all of the new runoff does not go to the pond, and it will be managed. I just want to point that out.
Okay. Anyone else? No. I make a motion that we continue this matter, keep the public hearing open until next month.
Second.
Okay. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much, and thank you to the neighbors.
Okay.
Simple Bethel.
Thank you.
You should appoint less time in his council on that one,
right? Yeah. Let's
go back on the record.
Okay. Continuation of that last motion, I move that Lester Steinman be appointed as counsel representing the board on the Singh matter. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Was there a second?
I'll second.
I'll second.
So Adriana doesn't have to.
Good evening, Chairman Cooper and members of the Zoning Board. My name is Rich Cordone with JMC. I'm back again tonight. Tonight talking about Temple, or back again in front of you tonight. First time talking about Temple Bethel. We're proposing to do a little bit of a sign replacement plan. As you can see, this is actually the view coming down Route 120 South Bedford Road going to the site driveways right here. You can see there's an existing sign over here. We're here seeking an amendment to special use permit most recently granted in 2008 that allows the existing site to operate as a synagogue and nursery school as a pre-existing non-conforming use. We're also here tonight requesting relief from Section 60, 410D, 12A, and C of the code, where we are proposing to use the installation of three signs versus the blessing.
Thank you.
Versus the permitted one sign, and I guess like an area variance on the total square footage of the aggregate signs we're proposing. It's 41 square feet of sign through all three signs versus 10 square feet that's permitted for one sign. As well as a 7-foot max dimension in any direction versus 5. Ross, the next slide. This is an aerial view of the site. The signs that we're proposing one sign over here, and another here. The sign this side and this side are both to be used to identify the site from South Bedford Road. You have the traffic that's going to be coming south on South Bedford Road, that they will be able to see this sign, and coming north, they'll be able to see this sign to identify the site. The geography of the site, or the layout of the land here, is pretty much, you're not able to see the building. The only way to identify the location of the site is the signs on the side of the road. So if you can go to the next slide, Ross. We're going to go, this is the sign that we have proposed over here for the entryway. We'll bring it back about 14 feet from the edge of the stop bar to make sure that there's no problems with the site distance. There's going to be a little bit of site distance that we have to clean up here, some brush and stuff. We've discussed that with Mr. Scioli, and we're addressing his comments. We'll be able to address his comments with really no fanfare. So this sign, if you go, Ross, next one, is you'll see over here, we propose it over here. That's that sign A that we're talking about. And the reason that we need the two signs over here for the driveway instead of just one is because you can actually see on the site here how it's kind of almost like a flag lot. And if we just have a sign here on this side, you're not going to be able to see it coming north. And if we just have a sign over here, you're not going to be able to see it coming south.
What precipitated this just generally? I get what you can and can't see, but
There's been a lot of people that have been getting lost trying to
okay.
get to the temple. There's a lot of visitors, a lot of new people
okay.
that have moved into the community. You've had, there's been a lot of development in recent years. So there's
okay.
a lot of people that are trying to find the community.
Okay.
So that's one of the biggest reasons. So as I said, this sign here, Ross, next one, we have an additional sign. This sign is on the other side of the driveway. And then you can go to the last sign, Ross, which is sign C. And this is actually a wayfinding sign that's further back.
Interior
to the site. This is about 150 feet back from the edge of the roadway. So as you can see, yes, these signs are fairly large considering. However, the allowable sign in the code for this zone, which is a residential zone, the only reason we're here is because we're permitted to be here as the site exists, I should say, is because it's, you know, it was constructed in 1969, the building permit was issued, and 1971, they changed the code and said, guess what? We're no longer allowing places of worship in a residential zone. So, go back right here.
So why doesn't 5 feet do it? Why do you need 7?
We need 7, and here, go back. Let's see what sign we need 7 feet for. Go back, next one. The 82. This is, in order to get this width here and to have it at a reasonable font size so that people can read it from a decent distance away, it kind of needs to be at that ratio. In order, if we were to drop that to 5 feet, it would be almost illegible.
So is there math behind that? I mean, is that signs are supposed to be of a certain height, you know, with traffic?
There is, for a little bit of background, there's a document out there that's called the MUTCD, which is the Manual of Uniform Traffic Control Devices. And what that does is, based upon the site distance that you have, the amount as far away as you could see, it kind of dictates and gives you an idea of the size of the font that you'd want on your signs, as well as, you know, the fact that we're setting it back a little bit further from the road. It really, you know, it's got to be a little
so
bit
this
bigger.
Is compliant
this with, is with this this makes sense as far as
visibility
right. it's a little bit uncompliant with the code, but you know, the code is written for, as I said before, it's for a residential application of 5 feet. And that's reasonable, you know, for a residential application. For this, for us to be producing a sign here that has an aggregate square footage of 10 square feet, that's going to be a tiny sign. That sign is about, it's, if I had a 3-foot by 4-foot board here, which is a lot of our presentation boards, that's bigger than, that's 12
square feet. Which will be a lit sign?
There will be, okay, there's going to be a spotlight here lighting up on it. It's not going to be a neon sign. There'll be a small, I believe they're called like pot lights. They look like little flower pots that are going to be pointing up on it. That is allowable by code in this application. So basically, our closing arguments are, you know, that on paper, the variances seem substantial. When you break it down with the three proposed signs and the fact that one of the signs is 150 feet inside the property, we really don't think that it's a substantial thing. As when you combine that with the massing of the site, when you average out the total square footage, you have three signs at 41 square feet. It averages out to about 13.7 feet a sign, which we don't feel is unreasonable either. That's fairly close to what the code is for a residential application. We don't feel as though there will be an impact, an adverse effect or impact on the environment or the physical or environmental conditions in the neighborhood. The signs already exist there right now. The temple's a good neighbor. I don't believe there's anybody, there's nobody here in opposition to the, we haven't heard any paper comments.
So no one here and I would like to speak to this application.
I'm with Temple Beth.
Oh, okay, good, okay.
Have you complied with the town engineer's comments of September 8th?
What I would like to do is I would like to meet with Mr. Scioli again and just confirm some of his comments, because I just want to run it by him again and make sure that I can answer to it correctly. Ross, if you go back to our site plan. Okay, go back over here. Mr. Scioli is commenting on the site distance with proposed sign C as we're exiting this driveway right here. I'm unsure if he really if it was made clear to him that this is a one-way in this way and a one-way that way, that for him, there's really, as far as site distance, we don't feel as though there's going to be an adverse effect on site distance anywhere here, since the traffic that's coming this way is either going to go straight or go this way. But
so when you leave us, you're going back to planning?
Well, we are going to have, I'm requesting, I would like to get a referral to the planning board as well as the ARB, because I know the ARB is going to have to look at this as well as the planning board.
I see. Okay.
You guys have any other questions?
No. I move that we close the public hearing.
No, you should leave the public hearing open until you get back.
Okay.
Okay.
So are we going to address, we're going
to
refer.
You'll make a motion to refer to the planning board and the ARB and to adjourn the public hearing until you have comments back. So
okay.
Get them back before the next meeting.
I'll make a motion that this application be referred to the planning board and the ARB for further consideration. Then at that time, you would return to the zoning board to adjudicate these variances that are required and the amended special use permit.
Okay. Thank you guys very much. Have a great night.
Second?
I second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Thank you. I move that we adopt the meeting minutes for the July 13th meeting.
I'll second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, we're off.